Gregorio!
Antonio!
Amy!
Hey, yo, what's up out there?
Ice Cube! I see.
That is not good.
Get ready to experience the thrill of a lifetime.
If you somehow find this offensive,
just don't listen. But my guess is you'll be sticking around.
Let's do it.
It's going down. Jack.
Hey, it's Larry King welcoming you to the Opie and Anthony Show right here on Sirius XM's satellite radio.
Oh, this is good radio right here.
Y'all are cooler than shit.
It starts funny and then gets very uncomfortable.
One of the most popular radio shows in the world.
Radio journalism at its best.
Hello, kids. It's the Opie and Anthony Show. They swear and they're vulgar and they talk about awful, awful things. That's what you like, isn't it?
Very flavorful.
Yay.
That's what you like, isn't it?
Please welcome Opie. The show is twisted, I'm telling you. We're enjoying this shit.
That's what you like, isn't it?
Anthony.
I want dick prizes. Oh, I love when girls go through that. I'm here for you, ladies. Remember that.
That's what you like, isn't it?
And Jim Norton.
If a pussy could talk, it would say, "Die."
That's what you like, isn't it?
Everything you are about to hear is real.
My nipples are kind of hard.
Good morning. Welcome aboard.
But enough of this palaver. Let's get the show on the road.
Yeah.
All right.
Morning, everybody.
Up and running.
That's right.
They say up and running. What a...
Most of us up and running. Most of us up and running.
Oh, no.
Wow, 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 wow. Wow, 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 wow. Sam, you're just getting here too, huh?
Oh, no.
It's late day for everybody, I guess.
I saw Sam when I came in, working diligently in the office.
That's what I do. It's my job.
Oh.
And you live the furthest away, I think.
Yeah, I live in Westchester.
What is that, like?
Westchester.
How far is that?
Snob.
5 minutes? 10 minutes?
No, it's about a 30-minute drive without traffic.
Oh, really?
25, 30 minutes.
Mm. Yeah, we got members on the staff that just don't want to get here on time.
Oh no,
it's crazy.
Not you. What happened today? What happened? Let's get it out there on the table.
I left at 6:01.
No,
no, Jimmy, you're not the problem.
Everybody's gonna find about you coming in.
I guess Iraq and Sal decided to get here around 5:55 or so.
Oh,
according
Jesus!
To Travis, who was very pissed off.
Oh no!
Were both of them?
Yeah. Yeah.
Uh-oh. How'd that happen? Were they hanging out together?
I don't know. Maybe they had a late night or something together.
Oh.
Don't we have a new boss? What are you doing? You get away with that shit with the idiots that were running this joint, but not the new guy.
He's gonna pay attention.
He's not gonna fucking put up with that shit.
You know what time we used to come in?
What?
4:30. 4:30.
And that's you know, I don't want to be the guy to say it, but I will say this much: yeah, that's when you should come in.
4:30.
We don't need anyone starting at 6:00.
And then when we got the bosses here, the old regime, in a meeting once when we were having issues with certain staff members being late all the time, they said, "We really don't see any reason why you can't be here by 5:30. And like Travis and me looked at each other like,
5:30?
Are you fucking kidding? This is fantastic. I can't believe it.
Oh my
God.
We don't need anyone at that point.
Of course. You need people here early.
I mean, some of you guys are on the air and you absolutely contribute to the on-air product. But in general, by showtime, we don't need anybody. We don't need to see Sal walking around at that point.
No.
He's useless today. And Eric's useless today. Sorry, but you are.
Oh, boy.
Because anyone can push the fucking buttons going into fucking break.
Apparently not. Sometimes.
Not on time.
Jesus.
It is a thing, though, that once the show's up and running...
There's no...
It's running.
Like, right, we don't need anyone. We're well prepared.
We're here to push you guys, and you're the wheels that move down that hill. It's
there
moving
it
now.
Now we're moving.
It's already been pushed. You don't need to show up at the top of the hill. It's already rolling down.
Oh, no.
Travis, what are you getting here now for? It's already down the hill.
What happened, Travis? Travis walked in really mad, and we asked, what's wrong?
I walk over to the printer to print out all the work that I've been doing for the last hour.
Oh, shit.
For the last hour. Like,
well, yeah.
I mean, think it's more than reasonable that the behind-the-scenes staff gets here at 5.
Sam and I
are not asking much.
Right.
Diligently working.
Sam told me, so you and Jesse told me he gets up at fucking, what time do you wake up?
3:55.
I couldn't get over it.
I get up at 3.
Like, why would anyone wake up that early?
He gets up at 3.
Oh, it's terrible.
3? 3,
yeah.
To make sure he's here by 5 to fucking help us out.
Oh, my God.
Hour and a half.
Well, now I'm starting to think, who are the stupid ones here?
Well, I don't think E-Rock's stupid because, you know, he got away with it for many, many years. But my point is that the new guy is not going to put up with that. I'm sorry.
That's the craziest part. I can't imagine the thinking behind getting here at 6 o'clock in the morning when we just got a new boss.
Right.
Just got a new boss.
Oh, E-Rock, comment? Look who's coming in, though. Brave, young, late Sal.
Plus, Sal knows he gets hammered for everything. Like, there is nothing this show likes to do more than hammer on Sal.
Oh, yeah.
I don't know.
Yeah, but we've been over this. Like, you know, you're working for your own fucking career, not ours.
Oh, boy.
Who the fuck's going to hire a guy that shows up at 5:55 for a morning show?
It starts at 6.
Well, I can be here 5 minutes before the show starts.
Like you should be working hard for your own fucking career. Holy
Work
shit.
Hard for the money. Din, 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 din. So hard for it.
So what happened, Travis? I didn't interrupt you.
That's fine. So I'm printing out all my work, and Kenny says, is Eric here? I said, I would assume so. It's 5:55.
He said,
I don't think Eric and Sal are here because nobody came to take my credit card for the coffee.
Oh, shit.
And I said, well, that's impossible. It's 5:55. So I walked back into the booth where normally one of them is manning the board
because
five minutes before showtime.
I would assume at 6, buttons have to be pushed.
Yeah. Sometimes before 6.
Oh.
You know what's great, too? I can only imagine, because when I get here, I try to find stuff for the show, right?
Sure.
So I don't know exactly everything else that's going on around here the first hour before the show. And Travis is looking for news articles, so he doesn't know everything else that's going around here the first hour before the show, because we're trying to be able to just pile shit in front of you guys that you might use 30% of it, hopefully.
That would be great.
The interns must have just been sitting here with nobody.
No. Of course. The interns are all here at 5:15, 5:30.
With nobody but Sal and Eric.
Who's in charge here? Ain't you?
So the interns are just sitting here like, what? Like, we're getting school credit for this?
Oh, no. The interns are here.
And it's not a rare occurrence is what I'm getting at here.
Oh,
it happens way too much. Like, Sal, you're useless.
Oh, Jesus.
I would like
you're absolutely useless today. You might as well go home. I don't give a fuck. The show will be great today, and it'll have nothing to do with you.
You want a filibuster?
No, I would like to.
Like Cruz? Get up there and filibuster.
I would like to just defend myself.
I could not in a box.
Sal, but there's nothing you can say. There's nothing you can say. You're working for your own career, and you still don't understand that.
I know.
It has nothing to do with us. Eventually, we'll be out of the business or moving on, and you're still a young kid with nowhere to go because you don't work hard.
Also, by the way, I heard that E-Rock called to say he was going to be late, but he called Sal, who was also late, so no one here knew.
Because he's not stupid. He calls the one guy that it doesn't matter you call when you're late.
But then you could say, hey, I called, but you didn't call, like, Travis.
Or text us.
Yeah.
I think he has my fucking number by now.
You didn't get a guess what?
Of course you call the weakest guy.
You know what time it is? Yeah,
you near a clock?
You near a clock.
Right.
Yeah. Sal, comment?
I instructed Travis earlier this month that for the entire month of September, there's train traffic.
Until further notice, I would be taking Mondays off.
This is not starting well. Yes.
I'm a man of leisure.
Man of leisure.
I instructed.
A banana must steam.
For the foreseeable future.
Yeah.
I told I told Travis that there's construction going on at the train that I take to come into work.
Oh,
for the entire month of September, I'll be getting here between 5:30 and 6. I usually get here at quarter after 5.
So what's the alternative to get here a little bit earlier?
Thank you, Jimmy.
I would have to
get up earlier.
Buy a cab or something like that.
Well, then you got to do what you got to do.
And I told you, I said, that's fine.
Right.
I said, but if you are going to be later close to 6... let me know.
You said later after 6. I got here before 6.
Sal.
Oh, my God.
You got here what?
I got here before 6.
By 2 minutes.
Still before 6. So I pay for a cab.
This is why I can't talk to, like, younger people.
Oh.
They don't even have a concept what they're doing to themselves.
I knew I wasn't going to be here after 6, so I didn't tell Travis. So dude, I bought a cab to get up here today.
It's fine that I was late. I knew I was going to be late.
You're a slacker. I mean, good luck being a slacker. You might be the first one that figures it out. But I know a million people in this business. No one would hire a guy like you.
You're a slacker, McFly.
I know a million people. They would never accept a guy showing up at 5:58, and then that person thinks it's okay to show up at 5:58.
It drives me nuts. I have Ajita coming here late every single day. But on the way up here, Eric texted me saying, "Hey, dude, I'm going to be a little bit late. Can you just run the board for me?"
Yeah.
This is so cool.
Yeah, late buddies.
Let's walk in together. We'll pretend we were in an accident.
What time did Eric text you?
When you get a text from Eric that says I'm going to be a little bit late, because on time for, you know how most people, if you're on time, you're late. If you're late, you're early for Eric. So, so when he says I'm going to be a little late, like, you're lucky he's here for the first hour of the show.
Eric texted me today at 5:51 a.m.
That's when the text at 5:51 it says I'm going to be late. Not like I'm panicking because I'm already 51 minutes late.
I was gonna say, Sal, you should have told me that Eric was gonna be late, but it's 5:51.
Yeah, that's
I said I'm not there yet. You gotta ask Travis.
And he's not there yet.
I'm not there yet.
That's what I said. What else am I gonna say? I'm not there. And Eric writes, okay.
Can you process this, Sam?
I don't know what happened. Can't even wrap my head around this because he has no awareness that this is a problem.
Oh, I love it.
I know it's a
for
problem.
For your own life, not even our lives, because I don't need you to do a radio show, period.
I understand that, but
we gave you a pretty amazing break in this business, and you're blowing it. Because eventually you're going to have to move on with however it happens, and no one's going to fucking hire you.
Oh, geez.
You're just going to be a low-level who-gives-a-fuck guy in this business. You have no comprehension.
I'm just saying I had a scenario.
Because it's your fucking generation. I have to say it.
I told you. I said, if it's going to be closer to 6, let me know. I said, I understand if you're going to be here.
You said after 6.
Sal, why would I say after 6?
You don't even have the time.
After 6 o'clock doesn't matter.
I knew I was going to get here before 6.
Sal, let me ask you.
I can't even voice my own opinion.
Why would I tell you to let me know if it's going to be after 6 when after 6 the show is on? I need to know before 6.
We all know when the show starts. So you told me that specific time to let you know.
Right,
I covered for it.
What time?
I covered for you when you're not here, and I don't say anything about it either.
Oh, you're not supposed to say anything. It's your fucking job.
Oh.
I cover for you when you're not here. You're not supposed... this isn't like, I covered for Travis the last 3 days. Let me come in late, and it's totally fucking okay.
No, it doesn't, but I'm just saying we all help each other out when we're trying to cover for the other person. That's all I'm saying. We all work together. We try to work together, but it turns into everyone fucking throwing the other person.
Yeah, and I let you know that I wasn't going to be here. I let you know days ahead of time. I didn't let you know 5 minutes ahead of time.
I'm just saying
that in
the event that something is going on, someone's not going to be here or whatever. The other people step up around here and they help the other person out. But it all turns into is this guy's not here. Fuck him. That's all it fucking turns into.
No, it doesn't. If you texted me and you said I'm not going to be here until 6 today, I would have covered for you. But you didn't. So how the fuck am I supposed to cover for you? I can't do my own job and call everyone on the staff to make sure that they're going to be here on time, or I got to do their fucking job too, okay?
Nobody
else in the world calls their staff every morning and says, hey, you going to be here on time, or should I do your job today?
But how am I supposed to anticipate Eric going to be here late? So I'm not here, so all of a sudden, everyone else's responsibilities fall under me. You're here!
I will now be accepting you are a genius.
I'm here doing my job. You want to let me know you're going to be a little later than normal? That's fine. But
if you
don't...
my job to launch. I don't do that. Eric does that, so it's coming down on me for some fucking reason. You're the only other person here who could launch Delight, get the
it's
show
It's coming down on you because you were late. It doesn't matter what your job here is. You're still late.
I understand that, but you were instructed earlier. I told you 6 weeks ago.
Stop telling me you instructed me to do
I
something.
I told you 6 weeks ago that I was going to be here between 5:30 and 6 for the rest of the month. So the one day that Eric shows up late, this is my fucking fault? This is
ridiculous. I'm not saying it's your fault that
it
Eric
is
late.
You just said it's my fault.
Oh.
You're the only other person here who could cover for if
when
I'm not
say
here.
It was your
Eric
fault that
here.
Eric was late.
This is fucking ridiculous.
It's your fault you were late. It's not your fault that Eric was
late. Going
home. I told you earlier this month that I'm going to be here between 5:30 and 6 every day.
And I said, that's fine. Let me know if it's going to be closer to 6 instead of 5:30. Because normally you were here closer to 5:30 than 6.
But he's saying you said after 6.
You know
I never would have
said
after 6.
I think we should see what Troy Kwan thinks about
this. No. It's all fine.
Troy doesn't have an opinion.
He gets here nice and early. We should ask him how he figures it out.
No.
Oh, my God.
But, Sal, we don't need you at 5:30. We don't need you at 6 o'clock. Like, what are you doing for the show today now that you showed up at 5:55?
I will be on phones between 6 o'clock.
We might take two to three phone calls a day.
Regardless of if you take calls or not, I need to be there to
do it. So if you're not there, we won't take phone calls today. Who cares?
The intern would do it.
The intern would do it, right?
Mm-hmm.
Oh, my goodness.
And why can't you come in earlier?
What's that?
It's a hassle that your trains are all fucked up, but why can't you come in earlier
for a month? I cannot afford a $30 cab ride.
What time would you have to get up earlier to catch the earlier train?
There's construction between 11:59 p.m. the night before till 5 a.m.
Let me ask you, could you take a cab to a different train stop? That way it wouldn't cost $30. It would cost like $5 for the cab.
Right.
And then you get on a different train.
Oh,
I suppose
I could take a shorter
But it's mainly getting from Brooklyn to New York. Like, once I'm in New York, I could take a cab or take any other of the numerous trains that run at that time. Yeah, I, in theory, could do that. But it's just as expensive.
So your train, by your house is not running between...
It doesn't run between 11:59 the night before and 5 a.m. the next day.
And then from 5, it takes how long to get here?
On a normal day, if everything works out beautifully, I get on the 4:45 train at my stop, and I get to work at 5:15. So it takes about roughly a half hour if everything works smoothly.
So then what happened this morning?
Everything didn't work so smoothly.
I'm waiting at my stop waiting for the first train to
come. Oh, the train didn't show up?
Oh,
okay. The train showed up late.
It varies. Like sometimes
it's New York subways.
I know.
Sal's not saying anything that's not
right.
True. I've sat at train stations for 20
minutes
waiting for a train.
They're fucking crazy.
And then you miss that train, and then you're waiting for a long interval for
the
next transfer.
You know the guy you made fun of, Denny? You know.
Uh-oh.
And he does. I mean, I'll be honest. He doesn't really do much around here, but he at least shows up. He at least shows up, and he's ready to go at any fucking moment if they call his number.
I understand.
If they need him to come out of the fucking bullpen,
he's
you know
just
what?
Waiting
he's
for the coach
he's
to
just
put him
waiting.
In.
He doesn't have to even be here, but he makes sure he gets here nice and early.
Put me in coach. I'm ready to play today.
Oh, Sal went
put
through.
Put me in coach.
He went through a full internship. He's paid his dues.
I know.
That's true.
What happens. You know?
I'm just saying, like, I don't. It's frustrating that since Eric came here. I'm not trying to throw Eric under the bus.
Oh,
Eric gets here
at
his normal time. Everything's understood. He does his job.
What's his normal time?
It's like around between 5:50 and 6. Like any time around there.
That's his normal time.
But whatever. It doesn't matter. Eric gets here. He does that job.
Eric, you want to comment
here,
or
so
you're going
to
just sit there?
E-Rock, comment.
No, I'm not trying to throw
and
Eric
And
I've
talked
the bus,
to him man. About this a million fucking times.
Uh-oh, I think I see club soda. Oh, I thought he was coming in. Oh, boy. Okay, E-Rock, comment?
I'm not usually here between 5:50 and 6 o'clock.
That's what he says.
That's what Sal's saying.
Uh-oh.
What time are you normally here?
Usually around 5:40. That's not that much better, but...
A little closer to 5:45. Squeak there. Squeak down a little bit. Maybe it's... It's 5:48 to 5:50.
We should never beat half the staff into the show.
What time do you get here, Opie?
5:30. Sit there and I read 4 fucking papers and then I go.
Oh my God.
5:30.
Yeah.
Do you ever look around like, oh, I have an idea for today's show, but there's no one to tell?
There's literally no one.
There's nobody around to tell.
No.
There's nobody. Yeah.
There are actually at least 3 interesting stories on 1010 Wins on the way in, but talk about the inability to multitask. That's me. I mean, there's no secret there. And trying to drive like a maniac like I do, like I think and go, okay, I'll remember that, and then I don't. If somebody was in earlier, like during the time I'm driving in and actually listening to Wins, maybe in the background while they do something else and just hear those little tidbits, I won't say nugget, tidbit stories, you know, things like that, maybe that we could do something on. Oh, my God, the Yankees fucked up their Mariano Rivera bobblehead doll fucking giveaway yesterday. They weren't fucking, they didn't get there on time. The trucks didn't get there. There's a stadium full of fucking
Eric
people.
Eric and Sal driving the trucks?
Oh! Yeah, a stadium full of people waiting for their free Mariano Rivera bobbleheads. Oh, it was like a riot. And then they had a lineup for fucking, like, the complete side of a stadium, up the ramp, back downstairs, across, with vouchers in their hands from the third inning, then missing the game. It was a disaster. And John Montone's talking about it. It's like, and I think they rehired George Costanza. Yeah, it was funny.
But how bad do you need a bobblehead?
People want these Mariano Rivera bobbleheads.
Fuck the bobblehead.
They want, and tonight, Charlie Brown bobblehead dolls. So we'll see if they redeem themselves.
Not going to get me today.
No, I swear. It's a Charlie Brown bobblehead.
Yeah, bullshit.
Or
this Rivera thing didn't happen.
I know. I'm the boy that cried Costanza.
Mars, you want to jump in on this one or what?
I'm always here real early.
Oh, when you're here.
What time you wake up?
This guy takes more time off.
What?
Two.
He wakes up two.
Two?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Two. And the reason I do that is because if I miss that bus, then I have an hour to wait for the next bus, and I'm still here on time.
Oh, man.
See, I mean, you know, if you guys can't get here early, then fucking, I don't want you fired, but we'll fucking move you somewhere else. We don't need you.
October 1st, I'm going to go back to my
to what? Routine. Which is 5:30 or 5:40.
No, I get here a quarter after 5.
I can't give you tomorrow. I can't give you the rest of the week.
I'm not going to take that idea that Sam had about taking a cab to another station.
I simply cannot, I honestly cannot afford that.
I'm going to tell you one thing.
I don't know if I can expense it.
Next Tuesday, I will be here on time.
We'll get you a boring job in one of these dumb, tiny little fucking studios as a board op.
Where they come in at like 9 to 5.
Yeah, you'll have a nice life.
Working 9 to 5. Damn, what a way to make a living.
There's literally 3 work days left in the month, and he goes, I simply cannot afford 3 cab rides.
I paid for one today. It just adds up. I simply can't do it.
Yeah, yeah.
You gotta do it.
I know, and I've told you, expense it. You can expense a ride to work.
Do you understand the work ethic? I'll say it again. It's horrible, and it's not because you're letting us down, because in the end, we don't need you, and that's the truth.
Ouch.
But you're working for your own career, your own future. Why wouldn't you want to do that?
Look, this guy Mike is suggesting maybe Sal could take the trophy.
Participation?
World's greatest secretary.
Like, look at the work ethic in this room. Fucking Jimmy goes out to Leno to be on national TV, and he makes sure he's here the next day. He doesn't have to do that. If he told the company, look, I have to take a day because I'm doing Leno, they would never question it. But he does it. He gets on a fucking red eye just to make sure he's here the next day after doing Leno. That's crazy.
That's a fact, Sal.
Well, Jimmy's been shaking his head this whole time too, because it's mind-boggling.
Parkinson's.
Yes, I have to blow some later. I'm just getting ready.
Jimmy, it's mind-boggling, right?
Yeah.
Because you're a young guy. You're not established in anything yet. You get a few perks here and there when you get established, but you're still trying to work towards something. Why wouldn't you want to be here really early and really fucking put in an effort?
When I get here early, I can take care of my whole routine. I don't have to stress.
Even 5:15, believe it or not, is not that early.
5 is like, I would think 5 for people that are setting up for a 6 o'clock show, or, you know, technically when the buttons need to be pushed, you know, when the replays end and everything. I would think 5, an hour, 1 hour. It's a good rule of thumb for prepping for a show.
I don't think that's asking for much.
No, that's like the minimum.
Some do it in 5 to 10 minutes. I mean, if they could get it done in 5 to 10 minutes, why take an hour to do what you could do in 7 minutes?
Well, I didn't realize we had brilliant people around us. I could do a job in 5 minutes.
Time management.
Do you oversleep, E-Rock?
Yeah, E-Rock, what happened? We heard about the subway and stuff like that. Was I up late playing with some action figures?
No.
Writing fan fiction?
No.
Your movie?
Animaniacs DVDs?
No, it's DVDs? A
Coke float before bed, too much sugar, couldn't sleep.
Just one more.
That's a regular thing with him.
A-Rock,
then he gets, you know, then we talk about it, then he makes an effort for a while, and then he fades back to, you know, when he wants to come in.
At least fake it for a couple months.
He does. Oh. I'm not stupid. I'm very observant. Trust me. He does. He fakes it for a little while, and then he goes back to slowly but surely getting here 5:30, 5:40.
You think someone's going to be in nice and early tomorrow?
Of course. Give it a little while.
Give it time until the new boss isn't really paying that close attention anymore.
Oh, my God.
And then you start sliding back. You don't do it like...
Are you guys just thinking about the new boss getting wind of this and having a little meeting with you guys?
He will not be happy.
Oh, my God. No, come on in, guys. Take a seat. It won't be fun, Tim. It'll just be the... Yeah. Take a seat, guys. I was listening to the show this morning. What happened? What...
We're not going to put up with that bullshit around here anymore. We're not going to put up with it.
He'll fucking just verbally...
Yeah.
A verbal thrashing.
Which is not good because E-Rock's been all gold stars with Tim so far.
Uh-huh. Remember we were talking about that just the other day?
Yes.
How E-Rock was taking the reins at the meeting and...
That's why I'm befuddled by the whole thing.
Taking himself by the horns and really contributing.
So what happened? We didn't get your side of the story.
E-Rock,
I got stuck in traffic when I came out of the tunnel, and by the time I got here, I saw how late it was, and I texted Sal and said, hey, could you set up the board for 6, because...
What was wrong with the tunnel?
As soon as I got through the tunnel, it was traffic down 42nd because 8th Avenue was all backed up.
Boy, do you take 42nd Street?
That's where you come out of the tunnel, right to 42nd Street.
No, I know, but I mean, you actually make your right on 42nd Street?
Yeah, because it's usually dead at that time in the morning, and it was stuck in with cars and buses and everything.
So wait, well, I'm sorry to interrupt you. What time did you pull out of the tunnel?
It was like 5:30.
Oh. So what time did you text?
I texted him when I got to the garage downstairs.
Why wouldn't you text at 5:30?
There was no text pull off.
5:30, you see a bunch of traffic, you're like, uh-oh.
Yeah.
Uh-oh.
He couldn't find a texting rest area.
Ah, yeah, right, the little blue squares now.
Right. Yeah, why did you text in the garage?
I haven't put him up yet.
What time did he leave the house? What time did he leave the house?
E-Rock?
I left at 5.
5?
Left at 5.
I
was sitting in my work chair.
It's just so crazy because, like,
oh my God,
to me, when, because we've been through regime changes before, and to me, new boss time is fresh start time.
Fresh slate right there.
Like when we...
Because he's looking at everything.
You wipe it clean. No more Radio Wizard, no more fucking Steve Blatter. You just all of a sudden, it's a fresh start.
When we got Stump Brain, I could be like, this guy doesn't look at me like I'm just an intern like the old boy. And then we got the next guy. This guy will look at me like this. And now the new guy, I'll be like, I'll just be a rock star in front of him, how he'll look at me.
Yeah, you're on air fucking Sam
it's
Roberts.
A reset. Right.
Fucking,
it's a reset.
It's a reset.
Reset.
Oh, you get to do a new first impression.
And it's the same first impression.
And he keeps doing the same first impression.
Like, so maybe Moorings isn't for these guys. We'll get him on other gigs.
You think?
Yeah, I like them. I like the guys, but...
Throw them on music somewhere?
They make it obvious they don't like these hours. So we'll get them better hours.
Mm-hmm.
Because if you're not here early, then you really don't have to be here until 10 o'clock to start, doing what you do for the next show.
Opie was saying yesterday, we need those nuggets, those things that just spark conversation, the pop culture items, things that a lot of people are relating to. And on paper it might look silly, but, with our brilliance and genius, we turned it into amazing entertainment.
True.
Thank
Effortlessly.
You, thank you. And, those are the things that you have to, the only way to get them is to be there early, listening and pawing through things to see and find those things. You can't really find them with 10 minutes to go.
I watch 4 TVs just
for a nugget.
And we always pick up some little dumb thing that they're already doing on TV that we might have missed.
Right.
But then that's
and then
not...
we pick up the shit, you know, listening to 1010 Winds in the morning.
Right,
like
that's
you just
a big
said.
Thing. I listen to Winds all the way in and 88,
and then,
you know, all the way in.
Newspapers in general are a waste of time, but there's every once in a while you got something there like, oh, fuck, I didn't know about this. And you throw that at the guys and say, hey, remind me of this.
But then the staff can't say, well, they got MSNBC and 1010 Winds. They're all set. So I just show up when the show starts and be there to hit them buttons.
Hit them buttons. Let's get t-shirts made. Hit them buttons.
Hit them buttons.
With a little digital clock at the bottom that says 5:57.
Yeah. Hit them buttons.
Hit them buttons.
And all, you know, you should want to do it for yourself.
Do we have the prep sheets for the...
Because first of all, this business is dying.
Your business, it's dying.
So why make it easy for someone to just, you know, pass you by?
Mm-hmm.
Prep sheets for the guest.
That would be Sal.
Do we?
I have them. I printed them out. Yeah.
Okay. Thank you.
That is true. I mean, most people like with jobs like this are thinking, oh, "Holy shit, how replaceable am I?"
Right.
Like, I got to make sure I'm always there.
You have to be a commodity.
Yeah.
Oh, this.
Yes. Something special.
Yeah. Like, everyone's getting fired. This business is truly dying. There's not many shows anymore.
And the only way to get ahead is to be in the right place at the right time. So you have to put yourself in as many places at as many times as humanly possible.
It's a very competitive business. More and more models of radio are popping up in Pandora, Rhapsody, podcasts, online streaming. Just there's so many options besides regular radio and even satellite radio that if you're not a standout, take a hike.
It sounds corny, but if you don't, you got to make your mark. You got to do something that makes yourself irreplaceable or invaluable. Like you can't just, you don't want to just blend in and fucking pick up a check because they slash people, man.
Yeah, eventually they'll get to you.
And they haven't replaced any of the jobs. They've
Look at that.
It's not like they're cutting jobs and going, we can't wait to respend that money.
No, they don't fucking replace them. We've had guys that have fallen to the wayside.
We've lost half our staff.
They don't replace them.
And they haven't replaced anyone.
We're waiting to find out when we're getting Than's replacements.
Right. Yeah, exactly.
That was years ago.
All of our fucking replacements are over at Rockstar.
Yeah.
They're working there.
Yet every time that does happen, somebody comes into our office and tells me and Sam, well, we're going to start looking for somebody.
As soon as we fix the console in the studio. Hope. Please.
More responsibilities for me.
Oh, my God. You think Iraq and Sal are going to be commiserating later?
Fucking assholes.
Yeah, exactly.
That's all it is. And that's the only thing that's going to come out of this.
Right?
Those guys are fucking assholes.
Fucking assholes. Fuck them. Well, you know, that's... And then they'll say something about you.
Of course they will.
And then, oh, and Travis did. And then they'll say something about Travis.
Yeah. It's not about us. God, I can't stress that enough. It has nothing to do with us. You should do it for yourself.
Oh, man.
That's it.
Fuck.
Sal.
It's not going to be like... Here's, like, figuring out, yes, there is indeed a problem. This is what I, as an individual, can do to solve the problem. Mm-hmm. And then this will never happen again. And I won't have to put up with Sam. And I won't have to put up with Travis. And I won't have to put up with Opie and Anthony and Jim.
Sounds magical.
And this is the solution to the problem. It'll be,
those guys are being fucking assholes again. What can you do?
Oh, my God.
God, I don't want to raise a slacker. Fuck, it scares the shit out of me.
Oh, boy.
Because I see it all around me, man.
Put him to work.
So the people with kids out there, just push your kid and say, look, you know, the kids you go to school with, they're all assholes. They're all slackers.
Just listen.
So if you just fucking focus on something, you're going to be way ahead of everybody.
Listen to all the breaks I do about my dad and just follow those rules.
I saw the change. I don't know how many years ago it happened, but these kids come in and they just like expect everything to be handed to them immediately.
Oh my goodness.
You gotta give them nothing.
Dude, we
make them earn everything.
No one gave us a real break.
No.
Like Mommy Dearest. You don't get anything, Tina. Nothing.
Nothing.
And then when she died, nothing.
Nothing.
Simply in the position, why would anyone give Sam the ammunition? Like, why would you guys want to give Sam ammunition? Like, and like Sam's
like
an example.
It's like the Syrian rebels. You don't want to fucking arm them.
But he's a guy that does do a lot of shit, and it's like, you know.
Shit is right.
It's
a lot of it.
Utter, might I say, garbage. But I'm saying it's one thing after another. Like, okay, I'll do that. Okay, that's what you got to fucking do. It makes you very, very hard to replace because you're always.
Go-getter.
Yeah,
when you realize the quality's not there, you have to rely rely on quantity.
Quantity.
Of course. That's it. Your shitty voice, yeah, it doesn't matter. If you talk enough on enough stations, it doesn't matter.
Denny's a guy with a shitty voice. What Denny's struggling through.
And a shitty mind to go with it.
Everybody had a tiny little head, like a neatly coiffed Doberman Pinscher, Denny looks. Just sitting there gently barking at everyone that walks by. How's your day?
Hot mic. Yeah, wow. So tomorrow, what time can we expect you tomorrow, Sal?
I'll take a cab into the city.
I feel bad because you know you're gonna be spending extra money. How about you can expense it.
Like they said, how about the other subway? They can't just take it to another train.
I'll take the cab from Brooklyn into Manhattan. I'll take the subway. So
you know what that money is? An investment in yourself.
In your future.
Did you text Eric back? Saying I wasn't here?
Yeah.
Why didn't Eric text somebody else?
Like Citadel stock and investment.
Because if Eric texted somebody else, then they would know that it was minutes before the show started and he wasn't there. He was hoping that everything would just fix itself and this first break would never
happen.
Here's
what he was hoping. Sal was here. And he would text Sal and say, I'm gonna be late, which means I'm late already, ridiculously late already. Right. Sal is already here and goes, oh, it's okay, cool. I got the board and stuff like that. Don't worry. And then he comes in, Iraq comes in, and everything's fine. And no one noticed, and it's good. But he didn't expect the monkey wrench of Sal also being late. And that fucked his whole game up.
I told Travis and Eric this entire month this
I'm not talking about you.
I'm saying that you replied to Eric saying I'm not here either and Eric said all right.
Iraq, were you practicing a tad of deception?
More texts
comment?
Left.
A little?
No, when Sal wrote me back I was already on my way up the building and
made the text to Sal, were you already practicing a tad bit of deception on coming in a little late and trying to dodge that bullet?
No, it was more of I gotta make sure that the board was ready at 6 a.m.
So I texted at 5:52. I've been late
before. That was my backup, so I thought he was already up here, and I said, "Hey, could you take care of the board?" And he tells me, "Oh, I'm not here."
Oh,
and I was already in the elevator coming up.
I've been late because of traffic. You get stuck at, right before the George Washington Bridge.
Mm-hmm.
I texted while I was in traffic.
Yeah, yeah,
not after you get out of traffic.
That's what I don't understand. It's
that
like
you parked.
And then I found a new way to drive to work.
I've done that before, too. If somebody fucks up on the expressway and there's a lot of traffic, I will text Kenny, Travis, and just be like, oh, fuck, the expressway's fucked. I send a picture so they know I'm not lying. I'm like, look, taillights, fucker. I send a picture.
Yeah, you don't need to do all that. You're one of the hosts. You're Anthony of Opie and Anthony. You can just say no one's thinking that you're making it up.
I'm late.
I've texted Sam before at 4 in the morning. I'm even like, he might not be awake yet to let him know that I already know I'm going to be late.
Oh, man.
The subway's not
fucked
working
up.
Yeah, that's what the hard part is, that when you came out into the traffic, why wouldn't you just fire off a text? You're like, it's fucking 5:35. Here, there's something going on.
And send the text to Sal, Travis, Sam.
And then even if you're not late, like if you send somebody a text and say, I may be late, or I'll probably be late, and then you show up and you're not that late, you look like a million bucks.
Yes. You rushed out of you. Yeah.
You're over-prepared.
And I'm saying that E-Rock did not send that text to inform anybody that he was going to be late.
True.
Because he knows it's a problem.
He sent that text to cover himself with Sal saying, hey, cover me, I'm not going to be there. If you wanted to let people know you were going to be late with that text, you would have texted Travis.
But you send it at 5:51 to Sal, thinking, number one, Sal's not going to tell anybody.
Uh-huh.
Number two, it's so late, everybody's in a panic. Opie and Anthony are already talking about what they're going to talk about on the show. So this will just
wheel right in there.
Right. Nobody will ever know what happened.
He doesn't text anyone else because he knows this is an ongoing issue.
Right, he knows if he texted me.
Like when you guys are late, when either Sam or Travis is late, we notice because it's like, wow, that's weird.
Right, because it's a strange occurrence.
Right.
I hope everything's okay is what you think.
Right, yeah, and it's completely acceptable because none of us are perfect.
Right.
But I already expect E-Rock to be late every day.
But E-Rock also knows if he texted me or Travis that our first stop would be, hey, Opie, Anthony, E-Rock's going to be late. And then our second stop would be, hey, Sal, could you cover this?
Yeah, you might want to Travis or even Sam, you might want to text at 5:30. Hey, look, just popped out of the tunnel. Or even in the tunnel. You can send a text to the tunnel.
If that's where the traffic is, sure.
Yeah, oh. I mean, texts go through now. They used to not, but now if you're in the tunnel,
Well, you gave us a good hour radio, so I guess you are doing your jobs well.
Technically,
they did their jobs well today. Gave us an hour.
Yeah.
Whatever.
An hour ago, he wasn't even here yet.
No.
He's in bed.
Sam, are you saying you think there's some oversleeping going on?
Oh, yeah. I'm very suspicious of the traffic situation.
Ah.
Very suspicious.
You don't buy it?
I don't buy it. I believe that there was about 90 seconds of traffic, and that was like, yes.
Oh, what's he showing?
Hold on.
What's he showing you?
Oh, it's cockpit.
Okay, he's got a photo of the traffic that he can show us at 6:52.
What time did you take the picture, Rock? Is there a timestamp on it?
If there is, I don't know.
Just keeps it handy.
Yeah, it was probably Saturday night.
Fucking...
No.
He doesn't know how to find it. All.
Yeah, hold on.
No, the phone doesn't usually timestamp.
Yeah, there's no timestamps on it.
Because he didn't send it to anyone. He just took the photo.
This is right, yeah.
Wait, is that the last photo you took?
Yeah.
Okay. So why wouldn't you have sent, instead of taking pictures, why wouldn't you have sent the text to the proper people?
Yeah. This is the time I was late to work.
Yeah. Look closely. The fucking Trade Center towers are in that picture.
Yeah, why wouldn't you, instead of doing the photo thing, why wouldn't you just send the text to Travis?
Take a photo, 20 minutes later, send a text.
Yeah, what?
Yeah, I don't
understand. Why would you take a photo?
Right.
Like, you know you're late. So you're like, okay, so this is what... Here's a photo because you need proof, right? So at that point, you know you're going to be late.
But as then you, quick as you could send that text, that's the better.
But then you wait.
Yes.
Until you're out of all the traffic. Photo is a memory at this point. And you're in the garage going, oh, maybe I could text someone.
Why?
That was the fail safe. Just in case, because like you do the minimal text out. Just in case there was a problem, you hold up the thing. See? Oh, all right.
How come you took the photo so long before you sent the text?
Once I got off 42nd and I saw this was really, really bad, I took the photo. I didn't text anybody else. I should have.
But you get off, off 42nd from where? You got off 42nd?
Off 42nd going on to 8th. And it was really bad, so I had to turn back off 8th and go around all the way around through 6th to come around
to the building. You took the photo because you're like, I'm going to be late and I need proof, correct?
Well, any time something has happened,
that's fine.
No matter what it was, I've always taken a photo.
So at that point, you know you're going to be late.
Yeah.
So you didn't think to send somebody a text instead of, I could have a photo of this moment.
Yeah, I should have, but I did not.
What were you thinking? That's a fair question.
At that point, after I took the photo, I was trying to get out of the way with all the fire trucks.
A little something for the scrapbook.
And I turned off.
So you were going to, but there was impending danger.
No, I was trying to move out of the way.
How to get out of Spider-Man's way. How long does it take to avoid fire trucks?
Yeah, exactly. I understand that there was obviously something very, very dangerous happening. You couldn't be lollygagging texting. And yeah.
Once I turned off and it was clear so I could head to 6th Avenue, I just floored it all the way down.
Fair enough. We're glad you're okay. Don't get angry.
Obviously, you had a close call.
Yeah.
I was lucky to have you.
Yep.
Yeah. At any time, really.
Really, when you think about it.
It's a blessing.
You don't want to do the bare minimum just to squeak by. It's like you want to do something that makes you fucking stand out. Cause even if it's competitive, man.
And even if you don't have any goals beyond the Opie and Anthony show, like it's
an easy gig.
And you could argue that it's the biggest show on the platform. It's certainly the biggest show that's on 5 days a week on the platform by far.
Yes. Oh wow.
Yes.
What about 4 days a week?
Oh. Yeah, it's definitely the biggest show 4 days a week.
What
too.
About 3 days a week.
Mm-hmm. Is AGT on the air?
No.
That's arguable. But like over the summer? Definitely. Definitely over the summer.
In August, we're kings.
See, Sam's still keeping his options open. You see what he's doing there?
Smart.
Still keeping options open.
Yeah. Hey, look, you guys are the crown princes of all media.
But what I'm saying is, like, there are people in this building.
Yeah.
They're like, fuck, if I could just, like, I would love to work for ONA.
It's embarrassing how easy this gig is to begin with.
The hardest part is getting shit on when you fuck up.
Yeah.
The hardest part really is getting up early
getting
and getting
up.
Here.
Yeah,
that's the hardest fucking thing is getting up early.
Apparently
I've always said that.
Yep. It's the hardest part.
fucking breeze by the time you get in here.
Apparently so.
We're done by 10. I mean, I know you guys have a longer day than we do. No, I know you do. But still.
Yeah, but once 10 o'clock is over or 11 o'clock is...
You're just cruising.
Yeah, you don't have to worry about not fucking up. You just have to not fuck up in the morning.
I was in a restaurant, like Del Frisco's one day having lunch, and I'm looking at all these guys just a gentleman. But I was looking at all these people in their suits, and I'm like, what a fucking life that must be to have to do that.
Ugh.
Not that it's torture, but like just to sit there and have those dog shit office conversations with your uncomfortable clothing.
Well, you're
awful.
You realize you're lucky.
Oh, fuck.
In the end.
You're not snapping pictures with James Caan.
Yeah, exactly. I love getting pictures too. And I know that there are certain shows that don't let anybody get pictures. It's like it is fairly lax here.
We're very generous.
Ridiculously lax.
Very generous.
Oh, because we had lame asses, you know, overseeing the damn thing. But it's different now.
There are.
I don't even mean lax in a bad way. I mean like as far as freedoms are concerned. Like the show gives a lot of freedoms to all of us to do kind of, you know, it's not as strict as it could be, nearly.
There are a lot of jobs in this building alone that are significantly more difficult than this job.
Oh, yeah. And much more, like, regular jobs.
Yeah. A lot of shows to work for that are more difficult.
Oh, man.
And you don't get any exposure from them because nobody's listening.
I see people running around.
Yeah.
I need sports stats. Oh, okay.
They're saying there's a timestamp on the phone pick. Press down on the pick options. Options will come up and hit on detail. Yeah, I thought so.
Yeah.
Oh.
And I'll bet E-Rock's fairly...
Let me see if that works now. That's or if this guy's full of shite.
That definitely works, yeah.
I believe that Eric
just hit on details of picture in the options.
I believe that Eric is telling the truth about taking the photo in traffic.
Yes.
Can you see the timestamp?
It will back your story up.
It comes from the guy that had a branch in the way one day. Let's not forget.
But then he took a photo of the branch.
I know.
That is true.
Did not help his cause.
But that's what he does. Like, he'll show his evidence, and then the evidence is true, but it's only more damaging.
Of course.
Like, this becomes more damaging because now he knew enough to take a photo, but didn't think to text anybody to say, I'm going to be late.
I can't get any details.
What do you mean?
It doesn't come up on my phone. Not on an iPhone.
Yeah,
it comes up on yours, right, Mars?
Yes, sir.
What do you have?
The Galaxy S4.
See, it's all about the galaxy. I'm telling you. We got some tricks with these phones.
Maybe in the iPhone 6, they'll have time stamping as a feature.
Yeah.
But they'll come up with some crazy name for it.
Yeah. My phone does a great trick. The fucking video option disappears from the fucking... When I go to take a video... Sometimes I the great Danton. When I go to turn it, there's no option.
Look, details.
Oh, yeah.
That's cool.
And I took a picture of the bowl of Lucky Charms that I had to eat.
Oh.
Did you eat one yesterday?
At 12 p.m., see?
Oh,
it pops up on the Samsung, gives you, I was weak yesterday.
12 p.m.? That's not as bad. It's not like you did it at 12 in the morning.
No, but I came home and I just
had a Lucky Charms.
At least we have text message timestamps now.
Yes.
That's great.
Well, you know, we don't have in the iPhone now is when you want to delete certain... I send texts to myself
with
material ideas all the time and notes. And I go through and I edit and I delete them so it stays current because I always send myself... and now you can't do that.
So why?
I don't know.
I know.
So dumb.
And it's harder to make a call from a text. It used to be the call button was in your text, so I would be texting you and want to call you. Now you have to hit contacts, call, and then voice call. It's a three-step fucking process.
I don't like that.
Why are they adding steps?
Okay. Exactly. I noticed that too. It's like, what the fuck is this? I got to keep going.
By the way, can I... just make sure everyone knows that Sal has decided we were done with him.
Segment over.
He's like skulked out of here.
He just left.
That's right.
He just decided to leave.
That's the type of person we're dealing with.
That's right.
Oh.
He didn't hear a word we said.
No.
It's too bad.
Oh, boy. Oh, boy. He's coming back.
He's coming back. All right. Good, good, good.
I still support your Coke float theory, by the way.
So, yeah.
Yeah.
I was just stepping out for, like, I don't know, I thought you guys didn't want to talk to me.
Oh, jeez.
Just stepping out. Thought it was break time.
Who's taking phone calls?
Yeah, really, I thought it was breakfast time.
Who's on the phones right now?
And I remember one of Sal's selling points. Oh, sorry. I remember one of Sal's selling points when you were first an intern here.
Blowjobs?
Yes. Really, he had G/R, which meant give and receive, and I'm like, how do you pass that? But no, you, it was you, you were giving the other interns crap because they were not good workers. And I forget who the interns were at the time, but you really...
We always forget, yeah.
But you were all over them for being... I'm not saying you're an awful worker or a bad worker, but you want to do something. You don't want to just want to be fucking unnameable or unmemorable guy on the staff, because when jobs get cut, you want to be the one that they go, fuck, we got to move... You know, because you want to be on air, don't you? Or do you want to be in a producer or a producer's position?
Well,
I mean,
yeah.
Like, but you don't just want to be where you are. You want to forward motion.
Advance.
Yeah, advance.
Well, that ain't happening.
You don't think so?
Oh, no. Man.
No.
It's lateral, Sal.
What exactly is it you do here?
Yeah, you don't want to be in that position with a guy like Tim. I mean, not that Tim is a fucking tyrant.
But he's actually paying attention.
And he's been around for a long time.
He'll pay attention.
And Tim barrel talks. Every time I talk to Tim, the first thing I say, excuse me for interrupting, I just find this Tim will fucking
will
roll over you, man.
Roll, yep.
Yeah, and you don't want that to be in a negative...
Oh, my God, I can only imagine how fucking
he's
shitty that is.
He's fired people before.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, it's just part of his job. He knows how to fire people.
Gary and Blatter were kind of thrust onto this show.
I don't think Gary ever wanted it. So
no, it's not. He's more of a music guy, and you know, whatever. To be fair,
I don't think he really ever wanted it. I mean, we beat him up pretty good, obviously, but
in the end,
he's very happy he's not part of this anymore.
Tim's a guy.
And we've had nice conversations since, by the way.
Yeah, it's easier. There's no more pressure. It's
like... No, we were talking about Metallica the other day. Just like, wasn't that great? Yeah, it was wonderful.
But Sabian's a guy who wanted this, and he's a guy who does this. This is what he does, and it's like I'm not overselling Tim. I'm telling you,
he ain't gonna put up with shit.
And
he'll be nice about it, but he's not gonna put up with shit.
Yeah, but he can also be a motherfucker. I mean, he can also be very harsh. I remember from YSP, it's like, you know, he the station did well because he knew what he was doing.
He's a hammer.
I can't wait till tomorrow, bright and early, bright eyed and bushy tailed in the morning. Yeah, they're going to be here.
You're going to walk in, fucking Sal's going to have like a nice rag. He's going to be polishing the chair. Sit down, boss.
I'm telling you, Sal, if you've heard anything, do it for yourself. Should work really hard for yourself.
Like that production piece you did, which was awful, and we
which
made
one?
Fun of it. The it was about Roland, I think.
Get the... Panda angry!
Panda.
No, is that a lion?
Oh, it's still going. Panda.
That was a panda?
Yeah, angry.
But even though that was fairly disastrous and showed tremendously low ability level, it is memorable. And it was your thing. Oh. So you should be doing that constantly. Like, making production, it's like part of fucking, like, you know, I flop. If I go to get a picture of somebody, whatever, and I don't get it. I can either fucking slink away and not ask people, or fucking own it and make fun of it. You should do the same shit. You should be doing more production. And if it stinks, we will absolutely play it. Don't make it bad on purpose, because that will be obvious.
Yeah.
But if it's funny, it's funny. And if it's lousy, you use it. But you should be fucking just constantly doing stuff like that.
Like when me and Steve started doing The Inventor and Epstein.
Oh, of course.
And you guys destroyed
classics.
It.
Yeah.
And then we immediately went into the studio to record like five more.
Classics.
I fucking love those stupid things.
Yeah.
They grew on you.
The office mandate was, if you come up with something in the office, you have to make it a production.
Oh, right, yeah.
So anytime I would be silly in the office, I would be forced into a production studio to do characters.
Do it.
But
do
that's
it
what character. You do, yeah, that's what you do. It's like, and if it's shitty, there's going to be something that gets, that there's going to be something mindable in it or funny in it.
It's better to get shit upon for doing bad work than it is for not
showing up.
For not doing any work or for blending in and just being one of the fucking...
None of you liked... The Ramon bit the first time.
No.
Really?
Yeah. All three of you were like, what the fuck is this?
Probably, yeah.
Like, this makes no sense.
I miss Ramon.
Yeah.
Ramon.
And in fairness, it was a mediocre bit.
Stupid.
It made no sense.
No.
But then it grew on us.
It did.
We're not talking about Jimmy doing Ramon, by the way.
Steve doing Ramon. Right. Yeah, Steve.
Ramon.
Yeah, Ramon. Just idiocy. It was utter idiocy.
Wipe the shit from my shoes.
No context to it.
Right. None.
Yeah. But just Steve could be creative when he was in that right mindset and a production. Steve was a good production guy.
He was very creative.
Steve had no fear of failing.
No.
Because he enjoyed his characters so much that he didn't care if you liked him or not. Yep.
Exactly. He was having a good time with it.
And that's what you got to find, man. That's what you guys should be doing behind the scenes all the time, because that's the stuff that's memorable. Even if it's really funny, it's going to last. And if it stinks, we'll get stuff out of it.
Of course.
So we'll mock it. And you stand there, rather be in the barrel for putting in a piece of shit production that we can goof on than for, like, where the fuck were you? You're not here, you know.
I'm just thinking about Steve and his production now. I can't tell you how many times I was in that production booth and he wanted me to do something and he's just giggling like an idiot. And I'm like, I don't know if this is going to work. And he's just the happiest person with what he's come up with.
No. This is great. Do it.
Well, that bit about the you're in my fucking house. That bit stunk.
With Wild Bill, right?
It's a terrible bit. Yeah. It's hideous. It's poorly written. It means nothing. It was dumb. But there was something very funny in it. And we found something funny in it.
Because you're in Mav, you know.
Oh, it was abysmal.
Yeah.
A dreadful radio bit.
You didn't like it?
No, it was terrible.
Well, now we got to play that bit.
We certainly
have that laying around.
Yeah, we should have that in Dillette.
Mm-hmm.
All right.
Well, I guess that's it. The beginning of the show, you know.
Like, do you guys have any, like, do we have any, like, what, like, what's the, we have Rich Little in studio today.
Ooh.
Who's a fucking legend in my generation? We know him. Do we have any of his stuff pulled? Like, anything from Rich Little's moments or, like, little stuff like that? Not that we would absolutely use him, but, you know, and we have Michael Shannon from Boardwalk Empire. Like, do we have any, like, little momentary cool clips of him? The guy's a fucking
brilliant actor.
Just
going with the Rich Little. I mean, you know, we should have had something prepared that we could play in a break right here.
Yeah,
going, hey, Rich Little's coming in, and he did this once.
Yeah, here's him doing this on Carson. He probably did fucking 100 Carsons.
Yeah, like 20-something Carsons, I looked it up.
Oh, I was off by 80, but you know what I mean.
No, it's like
a... But we can't have those numbers. We can't have those discussions if half the staff is showing up at 5:50.
Yeah. Like, you want to make yourself indispensable where if, like, you're not here and that stuff doesn't get done, we notice. Why isn't that fucking... How come we don't have this stuff?
Or just take it upon yourself. Go, you know what? I know Rich Little's coming in. I know. Right. I did some research. I saw some YouTube clips you might be interested in. Here it is, just in case.
Yeah.
Boom, done.
Oh, let's see. Oh, it's Johnny Cash.
Let me hear him doing Johnny Cash.
Rich Little as Johnny Cash.
Yeah, I mean, time hasn't been kind to Rich Little.
Well, you know, it's been a long run.
But, I mean, at the time, everyone thought he was amazing. And then you look back and you realize maybe the impressions weren't that great.
Well,
could you start from the beginning? Sorry.
Yes.
Rich Little, who's coming in today, doing Johnny Cash. Let's see how good this is.
Hello, I'm Johnny Cash.
Yeah,
that's pretty good.
You all know how I feel about trains, those great iron horses that brought this nation together on gleaming ribbons of steel.
That's fucking good.
That's pretty damn good.
Smoke,
you just shut my fucking mouth.
Pulling cargo from Maine to California. From Michigan,
it's really weird when an impressionist, if we find one bad one they do, that's the one that sticks in the mind.
I know.
This is good.
Hey, looky yonder, coming down that railroad track.
Oh, it's wacky. Wacky video.
Yeah, they're showing trains crashing.
Holy shit.
That's not bad.
Pretty good.
Damn.
Yeah, that's pretty damn good.
Fuck.
Pretty damn good.
Oh.
Food's coming down the hall, so why don't we take a break?
Oh, yeah.
We got a really busy show today.
A lot of people. What do we got?
UFC middleweight champ Chris Weidman.
Fuck yeah. He's from Long Island.
Long Island guy, man.
Long Island guy doing made good. We like that. We like that a lot.
And Michael Shannon, who's in Boardwalk Empire. And,
right.
Who is he? What's he plays the guy who was the cop at one point. And then he's fucking great. And he was in that Ray Liotta movie. He played...
with the Iceman.
The Iceman. He played the Iceman.
Right.
Mm-hmm. See, I'm really looking forward to him coming in studio because I want to see if he's like... out of his mind.
He's crazy.
He's crazy on Boardwalk Empire.
Yeah, and he was crazy in Iceman.
Yeah.
Yeah.
He might just be crazy.
Might be crazy.
He's really good, man.
Maybe he's not really acting that much.
Yeah.
Huh? Oh, he's in the new Superman.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah. Crazy like that guy from No Country for Old Men crazy.
Javier Bardem?
Yeah, yeah. You look at him and you'd be like, this guy's just fucking crazy.
Yeah, you put a little Hansel haircut on that guy. Yeah. And he is nuts.
Oh, wow. They said he's going to play possibly, we'll ask him this, Elvis Presley in a movie about the meeting that Elvis had with Richard Nixon in 1970.
Do a whole movie about the meeting?
It's going to be very short. It's going to be a lot about driving. Elvis gets traffic.
Hey, make a left right here.
And also, podcast number 20 is up today. Oh. The Opie and Anthony podcast, a new episode every Wednesday. This week, it's Stalker Patty getting high.
Yeah, this was a good one. Because instead of going like a best of Stalker Patty, we wanted to go with this because it's nice and long. But Joe Rogan's in for it.
Nice.
I think it's one of Ari Shaffir's first appearances.
Nice. Oh. Didn't Ari show his ball
bag? He showed his dick.
Oh, that's right.
Yeah,
right.
He pulled his dick out of his pants, and we all pretended we couldn't see it. We gave Patty a breath strip.
Right.
And Rogan looked at her like, you know that there's marijuana on that, right? Oh. That's a THC strip. And right. She started freaking out.
She freaked out, yes.
And she really thought she was high. She was not high, obviously. I
remember. No, just Listerine.
I don't like this.
Yeah.
A lot of our podcasts featured Joe Rogan in the end, indirectly.
Yeah.
Did a lot of great radio with us.
Baby Bird was Rogan.
A lot of shit, man. So Rogan's on this one as well, podcast number 20. Go to our Facebook page, Opie and Anthony. There should be a link there, and you should know how to get it by now, hopefully. And spread the word, because like I say every week, there are people out there that just can't afford SiriusXM anymore, unfortunately. Mm-hmm. So this is a good way for them to kind of, you know, still be able to listen.
Yeah.
At least, right?
Yes.
All right.
The Opie and Anthony Show presents a Wild Bill production.
Due to the massive critical acclaim and commercial success of The Fan and Sam Show, XM202 is proud to present a new Opie and Anthony spinoff, a program that will surely take the radio world by storm, announcing Steve C. and his best friend Bill, starring Opie and Anthony's own Steve C. and his best friend forever, Bill the Intern, who is sensible, articulate, and certainly not crazy.
Hello, anyone home? Hello? Hiya, Steve. Swell condo.
What are you doing in my house?
Why are you pissed off? What's your fucking problem?
What's my problem? You're in my fucking house.
The door was open. I thought your wife was gonna cook us a nice organic dinner.
Honey, is there a problem?
No, nothing's wrong. Just stay in the living room. I'll handle it. Bill, get the fuck out now.
I can't leave.
Why not?
My parents just died, and you're my legal guardian.
That's terrible. I'm sorry. How'd your parents die?
In their sleep?
Bill again!
The Opie and Anthony Show continues in a moment.
Ready?
On action.
Gatorade, is it in you? Gatorade, is it in you? Gatorade, is it in you?
That's great.
Wait,
no.
Gatorade.
I got
it
here.
Is it in you?
Right. Ready? Is it in? Is it in you? Ready? Gatorade. Is it in you? Nope. Gatorade. Is it in you? Gatorade. Is it? Gatorade. Is it in you? Nope.
Last
one more time.
Try the last way you just said it, just conversational. Gatorade.
Okay.
Is it in you?
All right. Ready? Gatorade. Is it in you? Gatorade. Gatorade, is it in you? Gatorade. Gatorade, is it in you? Okay, ready? Gatorade, is it in you? No, don't like that. Gatorade, is it in you? Okay. Gatorade, is it in you? There it is.
You did a couple great ones.
Serious accents. The Opie and Anthony Show.
Well, Jordan, because 12 years ago, he announced that he was coming back to basketball.
Oh.
And Miley Cyrus wearing the 23.
You know.
That latest video of hers.
Me and Opie were watching a little of that this morning.
Wow.
And I want to not like her. I want to not like the way she looks. I want to make fun of her with the twerking shit from the MTV Awards. But then she's in that fucking video.
Yeah. She looks smoking.
She's kicking Lady Gaga and Katy Perry's ass as far as attention goes. She knows exactly what she's doing.
Mm-hmm.
And all these talking heads on TV thinking she's got issues. I think she kind of knows
like
what she's
Justin
doing.
Justin Bieber in the face, though. That's the creepiest part.
No, she's starting to look...
Bieber with makeup.
Yeah, she's starting to look like a lady boy.
A lady boy.
I think she's going for like a weird lady boy look.
Yeah.
And I think, you know, you can feel okay about that because that says more to the femininity of Justin Bieber than
right,
it does.
Right, exactly. The masculinity.
Yo, Bieber looks tougher these days with those tattoos. Let's not forget.
Oh,
and he's
man.
Got a little mustache going. He knows what he's doing.
He wears his pants down below his ass.
Yeah. It's almost precedent.
What song is she rapping in?
Miley Cyrus?
Yeah.
I'm not sure.
Where she's wearing the 23.
Is
yeah.
it new?
Yeah,
or
yeah.
Yeah.
No, it's very new.
It's extremely new. I think it hit yesterday.
Oh, yeah. It's fucking pretty hot.
It's very hot.
What's the new Miley Cyrus song? Come on.
Wrecking Ball.
No, not that one.
This isn't her song.
I know. It's somebody else's song.
She's doing a little,
in the video.
Doing a little rap for somebody else. Anybody?
Yeah,
no?
I think
anyone?
I got it.
It just hit
you got
today.
It?
Or yesterday.
Yes.
I've been running these meetings for quite a while, and you're just sort of in the background.
Oh, yeah.
I think you know what I'm talking about here.
Oh.
Jen, listen, I got to call you back. These kids. All right.
Oh, God.
Good actor.
I hate this shit. Just get to the song.
Come on.
A little story.
A drama.
Yeah, who is it?
Uh-oh, I saw Miley's eyes.
Whose video is this, Sam?
Well, it's...
Mike Will Made It?
Yeah, Mike Will Made It, and it's featuring Miley Cyrus and Juicy J and Wiz Khalifa. I don't know why Mike Will Made It, but I know Juicy J and Wiz, obviously.
She's fucking hot.
Yeah, she is.
Miley Cyrus?
Okay. Yes.
Yeah, she looks like Dolph Lundgren now. But I still fuck her.
She just shouldn't have worn those plastic fucking bottoms. Or latex,
it
whatever the hell
it
was.
Got all that attention.
Fresh, man.
Miley Cyrus is kind of what's up right now.
Yeah, she's...
Yeah.
That was a great move.
Oh, my
Jesus Christ.
She's in these little shorts and...
Her little Chicago Bulls outfit.
Oh, my God. Yeah.
God damn.
Yeah, this is... She's very sexy.
I'd kiss her bottom.
You would? What part?
Where the shit comes out.
She's rapping. Look out. Oh, shut up. Keep your mouth shut unless you're fucking got a cock going in it.
Exactly.
I hate the Wigger speak. It's hard to do rap unless you are doing the Wigger speak, but it's so annoying.
Just do the chorus.
What? Yeah. What happened? I haven't heard a word. She's fucking hot in this.
She does look really good in this video.
Oh my God. All right, we're just watching shit now.
Yeah.
Oh, my God.
And who else?
Just put that on the Facebook page. Because that just hit, I guess, overnight or yesterday or something. She's helping out this dude. She's rapping a little bit, and she's in this really ridiculous, skimpy 23.
Oh, it's very small,
Chicago
what she's
Bulls,
wearing.
Uniform.
Barely any material. Crazy. How about that?
You know the whole Sal thing?
Sale?
There's a story in the paper.
About Sale?
Well, no, I know where all this shit is coming from. Where we got to protect everybody and, you know, we don't want anyone to be sad or bullied or called names.
Mm-hmm.
And this is why these kids are growing up like this.
Mm-hmm.
I truly believe.
Absolutely.
Because they're never told anything negative. When we were told negative shit growing up, we're like, oh, fuck, we got to change our fucking tune.
Yeah.
We got to figure some shit out.
Now it's all positive reinforcement.
They're scared to be negative toward a kid.
Any negativity they want to keep away, and that's part of life. You're going to just fucking take all of his weaponry away.
I don't understand it because, you know, when you get into the workforce, it's not going to be the same shit.
Oh, yeah.
And so these kids are going to be completely surprised, like, what the fuck is happening? And then they're not going to know any better.
Something like today happens and they feel like their pants are around their ankles and they have no idea because they're not used to being talked
right.
to that way.
Well, today's little story, they're trying to get a mercy rule going as far as, you know, kids playing football. Now, here's the mercy rule. $200 fine at California Youth Football League. It's bringing protests because I've already learned in my just only a couple weeks having a kid in school that it absolutely is the minority that wants this shit to go down.
Uh-huh.
But for some reason, the majority's voice is not being heard.
Well, that's
so they continue
to
listen to the minority. At least one parent in the California Youth Football League is throwing a flag at the new enforcement of a $200 fine and possible suspension of any coach who allows his team to win a game by 35 points or more.
That's fucking ridiculous.
I played sports growing up. You got your ass kicked sometimes, yeah.
Yes.
And it was kind of a bummer.
To take a tough loss.
But if you really took that sport seriously, it made you try harder. Right. Or it also made you go, you know what, I don't really want to fucking play football. I'm going to try to find something that I'm good at.
And it's going to affect how these guys coach games. Or let's say you go up to 28-0 in the first quarter, which can happen. One turnover and three tight. What are you supposed to do now? Not play for three
not
more
play.
Fucking quarters?
Right. What if somebody fumbles, like, right there by your goal line, and the guy picks it up, and he's like, I can't run in?
Right, what do you do? Exactly.
I'm just going to fucking stand here.
Well, I told you an old story. My nephew was playing a lot of football, and at a very young age, if they were up by a certain amount of points in this league out east, they had to sit the defense. So now you got kids that aren't trying as hard when they're in the game because if they do so well, the penalty is that they have to sit.
That's fucking ridiculous.
So then, of course, you're going to get kids going, well, fuck, I guess we got to let them score here because I don't want to just sit now for doing my job well on the football field. Kelly McHugh, whose 13-year-old son is a kicker for the Sutter Huskies, said the risk of fines has hurt the teenage players' development. Yeah, of course, because they're afraid their coaches are going to get suspended and they're not going to have a coach to come out here and play football.
Who thought that rule up?
It's
ridiculous.
One stupid parent because their kid went home sad.
Their kid sucks.
That's how it happens. Because the parent doesn't know how to handle a sad kid.
And we've said it before. It's like you just got to teach somebody that losing is not a big deal. Like, that's the important thing. You got your ass kicked.
Right.
Here's why it's not a big deal. It's only a game. Like, you lost. It's okay. Teach people to fucking lose with some dignity and how it doesn't really matter. And that prepares you for fucking life.
At work now, doesn't the boss come around to everybody's, like, presentation on something that they're supposed to do in the office and say that they're all very good?
No.
And not pick just one, maybe?
No.
And, oh, really?
No.
That doesn't happen?
It does not, Anthony.
It's a bag.
It translates to one employee kicking ass. All right, we got to slow him fucking down and bring up everybody else. Of course that's not going to happen in the workplace.
So he's going to be like, so what happened?
You're not doing these kids any favors.
Yeah.
The world is fucking tough. It's a tough place.
They don't care.
So you prepare them for
the
tough place by bringing them up as wimps.
Yeah. The preparation for life is not very good these days.
It's unbelievable.
Yeah.
And you got one of these stories almost every day now.
They should take the curve off, too, though. Because in fairness, in academically, we all got like that little curve.
Yeah.
Which is kind of the same thing as don't run up the score. You know, like they should take that out, too. It's like if you get a 7, you get a 7. If you get a 93, you get a 93.
Yeah.
Florentine was just in talking about this as well, you know, and... In the NFL, coaches get fucking pissed off because they want to continue running their offense because it's early in the season. But the other coach thinks, oh, you're just running up the score on my team, and they get mad.
No, I'm playing. How about you fucking do the same,
right,
motherfuckers?
Right, because it's still early. I'm trying to figure out some offense shit here.
But they're not allowed to,
so that you see that even in NFL games. What, those guys can't handle it?
It's not my problem. Your team stinks.
Right.
They should bring a picture of Frank Reich. From the fucking Buffalo Bills to
Frank
these meetings.
Greatest comeback in NFL history.
And it's rare that happens, but it does happen.
The Houston Oilers.
Weren't they down 35-0?
Something like that. Yeah, a lot of people get confused and think it was Jim Kelly because he was the starting quarterback back then when they hear about the greatest comeback in NFL history. And it was Frank Reich, the backup.
Reich.
Came back from, I think it might have been even more than 35. I'm not sure. The North California Federation Youth League told the station that the rules were toughened because last year alone there were 30 instances in which the mercy rule was violated.
Violated? Who cares?
You're violated the mercy rule.
Plus, how? I guess we forgot that ice cream cures everything, too.
Right.
You get a kid, you talk to him for a few minutes, and like, yeah, you give him a little tussle, you go, let's get an ice cream cone.
Watch the Bad News Bears, and once they were at the pizza place, they didn't give a shit that they got their asses kicked on the field.
Here we go. Phones are lit.
Oh.
Because everyone's dealing with
this. Sal taking the calls? Sure hope so.
Kevin in Illinois. Everyone deals with this shit. Go ahead, Kevin.
Yeah, I'm a coach for a junior football tackle team, seventh graders. My son's on the team.
Sure.
And we played a game.
By the way, I got to interrupt you. You sound like a football coach. You got that cadence, you know.
Hey.
My son plays.
You know why? Because this really pisses me off. It's bullshit.
Right.
We were up. They kicked off to us. Our kid returned it for a touchdown. Opening drive. Right there. Touchdown. We kick off to them. They come out, bring their offense off. The first throw the quarterback does right to the same kid who scored a touchdown for us, intercepts the ball, right back down for a touchdown. First 30 seconds, we're up 14-0.
Right.
The coaches started pitching immediately on the other team, and our board even came down on us and said, hey, you guys got to stop this. Really? Because the coach over there, two fluke plays that we run two touchdowns back, and they pitch about it? Come on. This is getting ridiculous. And it's not just our team. It's other teams in my organization.
Yeah. Yep.
Yeah.
Jeez.
Yeah. I mean, in this story, it says one of the coaches says it's difficult to tell a player not to give it 100%. This is what it comes down to.
Mm-hmm.
But he said it is the price to pay for an opposing player not being demoralized. No, it's that's not.
Right. Sometimes you'll be demoralized.
Right.
In life.
That's what you learn. That's the lesson in sports is if you feel like you've lost, A, you shouldn't be demoralized.
Uh-huh.
And if you are temporarily, here's what you do. You get out of it.
Yeah. Yeah, find something else you
prioritize,
do.
Prioritize, not that important.
Well. Finally found something you do well.
Do you think the China people are doing this shit?
No.
Of course not.
Well,
and I've been saying it for years. The Chinese are coming.
Oh, man.
The world is extremely competitive, and it's becoming very small. So I guess we got to raise our kids to be fucking wimps, because that's how they're going to compete in the future.
It's just gearing up this country to be even worse than it is now with these fucking pussies.
And you know what? When I was playing sports, it was a lot easier to sleep at night when you got your ass kicked. You know, when you got destroyed, you slept very well. It was when you lost those very close games that kept you up at night.
Yeah, it doesn't...
Well,
Then
on Friday, the Friday night, the high school football game, the high school my kids are going to go into, they won the game 50-0.
Yeah.
And that was
it happens.
So I go back to our board and I say, look, I got a seventh grader, and you're bitching at us for being up 14 points in the first 30 seconds. Well, what did the high school do when we were kicking their ass 50-0? Did they pull anybody out? Did they change who plays where?
Well, according to Zarco, they're saying most high school programs have a mercy rule. It's up there. I just threw the article away, but it's like 45 points, I think, if you're up 45 points.
I saw 35 points was one of them. I think the California one was 35 points, which is absolute bullshit.
I think it should be 3 points. You can only win by a safety.
But Kevin, I've changed my tune because for a while there, I really thought that parents were getting soft. I'm like, what the fuck is wrong with parents?
Yeah, yeah.
And now that I'm in it just a little bit right now, I've already noticed that it absolutely is the minority, and most of the parents are like, what the fuck are you doing?
Just one fucking or two idiots.
Right.
Yeah.
I've been on shitty teams. I've been on really good teams. It kind of, in a weird way, it balances out in the end if you really, you know, decide you want to play sports.
Mm-hmm.
But that's what it boils down to.
If you enter that arena, you're gonna get whatever. I just fucking Jesus. But and why I repeat it though? It's so frustrating. It just doesn't seem to be the right thing to do.
There's no stopping it. I don't know.
I asked my brother, I'm like, why are they coming off the field? Oh, well, you see, the team's up by too much, so now we can't play our defense until they catch up. I'm like, what? What?
It doesn't make any sense.
So then my
sense.
Poor nephew, who at the time was a pretty good football player, he's moved on to a couple other sports because I think he doesn't want to have, you know, concussions by the time he's concussion problems
good
by
choice.
The time he's 15. He had to sit there. And wait, and then the other team absolutely did catch up, and then they were able to bring their real defense back in.
How is that
showing which team is the better team and the better players, and I don't know. Well, I don't know. It just seems counterproductive to everything.
Let's say hi to Ben in North Carolina. Ben.
Morning, boys.
Hey, man. Yep.
Hey, I'm in North Carolina. My son's school has got a first-year high school varsity team, and we've taken some pretty bad beatings already. But they have a rule here that if the score is more than 35 points, they play a running clock. The only time the clock will stop is if somebody calls a timeout. So an incomplete pass or a play out of bounds, the clock will continue to run.
They just get it over with.
They're just trying to get it over with.
Exactly. They still play the four quarters of football, but because the score is so out of hand, they just let the clock run continuously.
I don't like it, but it's not as bad as right. You know, the other fucking
rules. It's not as bad.
It's not as bad. At least you get to fucking continue, you know, with your starting lineup if you feel like it.
Well, you know, a couple of weeks ago we were down 42-6 at the end of the first quarter.
Right.
You want that over and done with. You know what I'm saying? You don't want to sit there and watch them beat up on you for another three quarters. So.
Yeah, but your field goal kicker must have been happy because he did well. Unless he's the asshole that missed, and that's why it was six.
Yeah, they missed a two-point conversion.
Oh, okay.
They're trying to catch up down 42-0. They went for two.
I was a scrub on one basketball team. And I always sat there on the bench hoping they ran up the score because that meant I was finally going to come in.
Going to get in?
Yes.
They'll take all their other players out?
Yeah. And then, you know, the ass beating would continue, but at least I felt like I was part of the team.
You're out there. Going to make the big comeback.
I started rooting for the other team after a while. Like, okay, another few points. I know I'm getting the call.
All right, boys. Thank you.
All right, man.
You know, I was thinking of this recently, what we're talking about right now. And I tried to look at the other side. I'm like, is there anything, again, I have no kid. Is there anything to be said for, like, what we're saying is like, you have to teach someone how to lose. But then is there anything on the other side which says that the more important thing is not, it's like, who cares if you're better at this than the other guys are? The more important thing is everybody kind of taking care of each other. And it was just a thought I had.
I think you can learn that and teach that, like, earlier in their age, you know, at home and like, really, like, preschool and kindergarten. I think by the time you're playing football, I think a kid understands that, you know, you're going to lose some things. You're not going to get everything you want. You can't cry about that. So, yeah, I see what you're saying. Is there something to that? But I think that information is imparted to kids earlier than when they're before they start playing football.
Comes down to this, man. Parenting is a motherfucker.
Oh,
I'm in it.
Is that a new book out there?
I would have that. I would fucking put it out there.
You should.
And if I need the asterisks, I'll go with it. I don't care.
But do you know how many that would sell, dude? That's an amazing
motherfucker.
Title. Parenting is a motherfucker.
It's not easy. It's a really hard job. And a lot of people have, you know, decide to tap out because it is too hard. So then they expect the community and the school and everything else to do these type of things because they don't want to deal with it. They just don't want to deal with it.
Yeah, I don't know how bad it was.
Huh?
To where they got to come up with these new wacky things.
Maybe because, you know, when we were growing up, you didn't have both parents working. I don't know. So maybe that helped a little bit. Who knows? Yeah, I don't know where this started. I have no idea.
That might be part of it.
You know, but
they want the schools to do more of their fucking jobs because both parents are working.
Like, my kid starts school. He's like 2 weeks in, and, you know, There's some called separation, so the parents kind of stay in the classroom until they feel like their kid's ready so you could leave. So you sit there and you watch, and to see your kid, like, trying to, like, socialize with other kids and they won't have it yet, it fucking breaks your heart. And then you go home with the kid, and you, even though he's only three, I already am having these little discussions with him. You know, it's tough. I know it's tough. You know, but I think other parents see that and go, well, fuck, I demand that you make that kid play with my kid. You know, it'll happen eventually. And actually, now that we're a couple weeks in, it is starting to happen. But at first, it was like, holy fuck. I saw him in the gym just trying to, like, socialize with kids, and a kid dropped the ball. So he got all excited, picked up the ball, and handed it back to this one kid, thinking in his three-year-old mind, aww, here's my moment. Maybe I can make a new friend or at least play a little bit. Kid yanks the ball out of his hand and runs away, and my heart just sinks.
Oh, what an asshole.
But I, you
little
know,
fuckwad.
But I understood it, but it still hurts because it's your kid. And my kid, to his credit, he has a smile on his face, and he goes on to the next thing, you know. And then a little girl dropped her dumb stuffed animal because she has to go to school with a stuffed animal. And he handed it back to her, and the same thing, yanking it out of his hand.
What would have been great is if you yelled at your son in front of everybody and said, "Never pick up the ball for a Jew." Just gave him a terrible life lesson.
Holy shit. That's so fucked up that they even have that thing where the parents are able to go there. Because I've told the story before with kindergarten when mommy dropped me off at kindergarten the first day. And
right.
Ms. Mulder. It was Ms. Mulder. She was from Holland. And she was the teacher. And she comes to the door of Cuba Hill Elementary School, and she takes my hand, and I start walking in the hallway, and I turn around like, "Hey, Mom," and she's like,
"Gone,"
walking to the car.
Yeah.
I fucking let out like the blood curdling scream, and Ms. Mulder is trying to like hold me back, and
fuck yeah.
And Mom just went. She said she knew I was going to be a fucking disaster. All pissy eyes started early.
See, Ant's not a good example for what we're saying, though. Well, because, like, you turned out brilliantly funny, but let's be honest, not exactly the example of emotional health. Like,
all right, I'm a little busted. Well,
you look at your 3-year-old son. Do you look at Anthony and go, "This is where I want him to be emotionally"?
I cried my first day, too, and my mom had to come and get me. Yeah. So yeah. They came up with this thing called separation, so they give you a little time.
Like, okay,
now,
yeah.
Now, I mean, to the credit of all the parents and the kids in this particular classroom, we're all gone now.
They ease you into it, huh?
Now it's like ease the kids into so it. Long and they're good, but it, yeah, you know, yeah. You're not sure, too,
oh,
about
man.
It. But
is it working? All of this stuff that they're trying. Like, mm-hmm. Every generation, we get progressively a little softer. And I'm not saying that's even bad.
I don't know. It goes back to, like, you know, every generation really believes they're the generation.
Right.
And every other generation just sucks a dick.
Right.
It's in yeah. a lyric, too. Whatever. I'll come up with it.
Meanwhile, none of us are Vikings.
No.
The quote is, every generation wants to be the last generation.
Right.
Because they think, you know, they got it all figured out.
Yeah.
Andy in Boston, listen to this one.
Andy.
Go ahead, Andy.
Good morning, gentlemen.
Yeah.
I was a coach of a 8-year-old soccer team. Sorry.
Me too.
I'm a lucky guy, aren't I? I was a coach for about 5 years for a local youth league. We finished the game one day, and one of the kids asked me if we had won or we had lost.
Yeah, because the kids don't even know anymore.
Yeah, yeah.
Because they can't even, like, bury that shit.
So I told one of the kids that we had lost and told him the score. Said, you know, we'll get him next week. I got a call later on that afternoon from the commissioner of the league saying that my services were no longer required. And this was an elite that was short of coaches in the first place, and they had begged me to come back. So... I pretty much told him to pound sand that,
hey,
you know, 8-year-olds can't handle winning and losing.
Pound sand.
What were you supposed to tell the kid? Like, hey, did we win or lose? What were you supposed to say?
I think that it was going on as you played your best, and it was a tie.
Oh,
but, you know, some of the kids there knew that they were getting their butts handed to them.
Yeah.
So.
Andy, are you in one of those leagues where they don't keep score? That's in quotations, obviously, because everyone else is.
That was one of the things that they kind of told you to do. But you know,
yeah, there's leagues now. They don't keep score, but of course the parents are.
Yeah, the parents know,
because they come from a place where it did matter what the score was. And then the kids get a little confused because they're not really paying that close attention. So I.
Uh-huh.
Yeah, this is one of the leagues where, you know, all the kids get to play, so you have about 25 kids on each team, and, you know, some are picking their nose in the corner while other ones are running around.
Some are spinning around in the outfield.
Yeah. Jimmy, what are you, a ballerina?
Oh.
No, I'm not.
Good moment.
Good comeback.
Good moment.
You know what? I'm suddenly for all this.
Thanks, Andy. But imagine a kid doing that today. The coach.
Yeah,
oh,
yeah.
My God.
He's not allowed to say, "Are you a ballerina?"
Ballerina.
Shaming him?
Right. Let me go to Ryan, who's a drill sergeant in Georgia. Ryan.
Hey, guys.
Hey, can we send Sal and E-Rock down to you for a nice week of drill sergeant?
If he needs a couple, if he needs to lose a couple pounds, I can burn it off of him. Hey, real quick though, with this, I've kind of conducted my own social experiment on this, and I've seen a lot of kids come through. Obviously, this newer generation, and I got to tell you, you guys couldn't be more right on. I see about like 10% of them that got beat up by their parent, or their parents beat them when they were kids. You know, they spanked them on the butt or smacked them in the face. Those kids have really, those kids can deal with anything. Charlie Sheen's idea of what a GI was, dealing with the rain, the muck, all the crap that you have to get beat up with in the military, those guys are the ones that make it in the military. These new kids, this Nintendo generation, and these kids that just want to play games and be fat and not do anything, those kids do not make it. And every single one I've seen, the ones that have failed have been the ones that were not beat by their parents, and the ones that made it were the ones that were beat by their parents.
He likes a good beating.
But see, he said Nintendo, because he's so into what he's doing, he has no idea.
Doesn't even know. Right.
I understood what you're saying there.
Of course.
I play GTA 5, so I'm right with Ant on that one. That one rocks.
I just know in our stupid business that it's changed with the new kids coming up.
Mm-hmm.
And somewhere along, I think it was when we came back to satellite, there was a big difference. But certainly in the last 5 years or so. When I started in radio, I was sleep deprived because all us low-level guys would pretty much stay at the radio station 16 hours a day. and when people tapped out and finally went home to sleep, that was your break.
Yeah,
they finally needed you for something, you know. But if we were all there, they're just like they're picking a guy. So you would stay there as long as fucking possible. I used to just wander around, I used to go into everyone's office, see what they did, see if I could help, even if it was something I didn't want to do in the future.
Just but I thought let that know little, there.
That I thought that little relationship might lead to something, you know.
Mm-hmm.
It finally got me to Brother Weez. Brother Weez didn't want anything to do with me at first, but I was a pain in the ass until he finally said, "All right, fuck."
I just look at it this way. I've been in the Army for 17 years now, and I've seen just a steady decline of soldiers and the way they act and what they do. I'm real happy to retire in 2 years.
All right. Can you give me some of that drill sergeant thing?
Hey, yeah, this is one of them. Hey, you got that?
Hey, you got that? I also saw a story about, I guess, Toys R Us is getting some shit these days for being gender specific. So they want to change it. You know how you go down the pink aisles for the girls' toys and the blue aisles for the boys' toys, and the bikes are separated by girls' bikes and boys' bikes? Someone's all up in arms about this. And
once again,
yes,
the minority.
Yes. And wants them to be gender unspecific, so that if you go to buy a bike, the boys' bikes and the girls' bikes are all in one spot. And the action figures will be with the girls' dolls and stuff. E-Rock, comment.
They have it in the UK. The stores don't have a boy section or a girl section.
Sure. Yeah.
They're all mixed together.
They all did it.
Some parent group in the United States thought that was a good idea and have been filing this petition to get Toys R Us in the United States to do it. And Toys R Us is saying, we don't promote boys and girls. They're just in sections by
it's
product.
Easier to
it
shop
just
that
makes
way.
It easy.
And it's then, like, oh, you're looking for a girl's bike. Let's fucking...
And you know what's going to happen? Some little boy is going to go into the bike section.
Uh-huh.
He's going to... This is what would have happened to me.
Yeah.
I would have accidentally bought a girl's bike thinking it was just a bike.
And now...
And I got my ass kicked.
Now you're getting beaten up.
All right. If we're talking about bikes, I've wondered about something.
Yeah.
Shouldn't we have the girl bike design?
Well, of course, yeah.
Because, I mean, I think a girl's pussy could take a hit to the...
yeah.
It could take a hit by that bar, right?
I don't think they were going for that way back in the old days when they designed that.
But shouldn't
that.
We have plenty of that, plenty of room?
You'd think. They just didn't want girls giving fucking snatch shots back in the day. Where they had to lift their leg when they're wearing a dress. And they had to lift their leg over that bar. They're giving fucking pussy
shots. That's why they came up with that?
That's exactly why they came up.
No way.
So a girl wouldn't have to
lift.
Yeah. It's absolutely. Wouldn't have to unladylike lift her leg over the bar.
I thought of that.
Because he was around when it was invented.
He's the reason buying my big front wheel and a little tiny back wheel bike.
He's the reason they had to change the design.
Yeah.
And fucking sitting there by the bike rack looking
right.
Old Concho Peacock fucking sitting there looking at the girls.
I thought it was because the girls wouldn't be able to help themselves and they would have to rub their vaginas forth while they rode their bike.
Yeah, I guess because of the strength and construction and just that, the bar on top is better. It's just a better design for a bicycle. But for ladies, they had to sweep that down.
That's funny. I had
get
no
a little
idea
leg in there.
Until today.
Yeah, yeah.
All right.
Yeah, that's about it.
Hmm.
Yeah, so they want to do that. And, like, if a girl wants to buy a Barbie doll, I want my Barbie. Why have them have to sort through, like, where the guy's stuff is and everything next to the G.I. Joes? No. You put it in the... And if you're a boy going into Toys R Us to buy something, you can eliminate half the fucking store. You won't have to go through it.
The problem is the kids see the toys on TV, and they want these ones that cross genders, and the parents don't want to have to say, well, that's the girls or that's the boys. So if it's all gender neutral, like, hey, no one can say anything.
And there's groups, though, that don't want that to even be said, like, that's girls, that's boys.
Oh,
They want the child to be able to get a dolly if you're a boy. And it was a puppet. It wasn't a doll. and they want, you know, if a kid wants a pink bicycle, a boy wants a pink bike, he should be able to do that. We shouldn't put stereotypes about sex on kids at that age, because then they get older and they shut up. Blue bike for the boy.
What's the new generation called? Millennials?
Millennials, yeah.
Ooh. Is that real?
Yeah, millennials.
All right,
yeah.
We got one that wants to defend the rest of the millennials. Eric, go ahead, buddy.
Hey guys, big fan of you guys. Just,
thanks.
I don't know. I don't know exactly what you guys want from our generation. I don't know what you mean by they don't like to work hard and stuff.
How old are you, Eric? If you don't mind me asking.
23.
Okay.
I guess kind of like Ann's discussion yesterday. I'm not saying every single one of you are like this, but I feel like a lot more are than our generation certainly.
Yeah, I get that, but I mean, it sounds as if every generation says that about their generation.
Yeah, we said that too.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
We absolutely said that.
It's true.
So, times change, you see something.
Say,
you know.
I don't know. We work hard. I'm in my job right now.
Do you feel that people are around the same age as you, around you, are slacking? That you see a lot of people that are slacking?
Not so much slacking, just not knowing really what to do. It's almost as if, I don't know, we feel as if everything's not been handed to us, just everything's been set for us. And then when we get out there, they're like, all right, now you got to find your, like, when you're...
Cut your hair and get a job!
But see, that's the result of it.
Now they don't even, like, show you how to, you know, build your own resume or anything, or
see,
make relationships with people, get a job or anything like that.
But I think that's because of how you guys were brought up.
Yeah, that's
the that's the point we're trying to make today, because then when you get in the real world, it ain't the same rules.
Yeah, I guess I get that, but like I said,
it sounds like you're aware of it, and you have figured out a workaround. But you're pretty much saying what we've been saying.
Yeah, I guess I am. But
but it's weird that when you look back at the other generations, like you look in the World War II generation that they call the greatest generation, and they were very hard workers. But you know what? Like, here's where we're better than them. They didn't understand anything about post-traumatic stress. They didn't understand anything about fucking, you know, you can't scream at your kid while you're drinking and expect them to grow up emotionally healthy.
Hey.
Like, but you know what I mean? They did a lot of shitty things that this generation and our generation is much fucking better at. So certain things suffer, but there are other things that come out that are, like, I think in a lot of ways we're a much better country now than we are were then, because we do... Like, you know, back then, discrimination against people and women, it was just terrible. Mm. And it was okay to be discriminatory. It was okay to fucking be like that. And now it's not. There's certain things that have balanced out, I think, that are better. Back then, they would just drink and smoke and scream at your kid. You could literally beat the dog shit out of your kid. It was fine. Yeah. Like, a lot of things are better at.
I guess, you know, trying to find a balance would be nice.
Yeah, because it's kind of swung in reverse.
Huh?
It's kind of swung.
Only kids that get...
Go ahead.
...were the ones that were... like, is that a bad thing that kids aren't getting beaten anymore? I don't know.
No, that's what I'm saying.
Yeah, Jimmy made that point.
It's
trying to find that balance, I think.
Because it's swung all the way in reverse. And the reason...
Sam just said the pendulum has swung.
Yes. But the reason nobody knows what they want to do is because, I mean, kids aren't really pushed to figure that out when they're coming up, because nobody wants to push you and see you fail at something. So if it's the same thing with sports. If there's a possibility of failing, we'll just let you pass by. Just keep sliding by until you get thrown out into the real world, and you're I don't know. I don't really want to do it, so I'm not going to.
Part of our progress, it is weird, is we are becoming a gentler planet or whatever. With the advanced technology.
Really?
Yeah,
see what happened in Kenya.
No, oh, yeah. Excluding certain African malls. But as it's a very slow...
Maybe you should say this another week or two when that starts fading
away. Yeah, that probably was a very bad week to make the point that we're gentle.
I'm sorry.
Yeah, what's Muhammad's mother's name? I don't know.
Right. Sorry, Jimmy.
But no, but I think that's the intent of what we're doing here. It's like, it's just... With the technology and all this, it just seems like everything is becoming a little bit gentler. People are trying to, because we still have a tribal mentality, even though we're advanced and smart.
Yeah, yeah.
It's not as much about what it used to be, but it's still tribal. We still don't look at ourselves as a planetary unit, which Dr. Kaku says we probably need to do before we really advance into...
That's so out of the realm of fucking, like, thinking about. Like, now you can't even imagine the world, like, fucking thinking as one. Get at it.
But more now you can than you could 100 years ago,
no.
Sure.
We got a Generation X that wants to talk to the millennial.
Oh. Okay.
Jen in Rhode Island, you're on with Eric in Baltimore.
Hi. I'm actually a Gen X, and yes. I train millennials for my company and the management track. And
I have an X-Gen.
I mean, he made a comment, and I'm not attacking him in his comment, but to me, his comment was exactly the kind of thing I hear. He says, no one taught us how to make a resume. No one taught us how to find a job. Well, no one taught me, but we figured it out.
You just found people. You found someone that did it. Yeah. And they walked you through it.
Gen Xers, they got shit on, too. They were called the exact same things millennials were called. Oh, the lost generation of fucking kids that don't know what the fuck they're doing. Same fucking shit.
And millennials will say that to their kids. Oh, you and your iris scans or whatever.
But Gen Xers entered a world after college where everybody was hiring everybody.
Well, there you go. That's kind of true.
You know, and millennials are entering a world where nobody's hiring anybody.
Yeah, but the economy hasn't always been great when people get out of college and hire, you know. Eh.
And the jobs that these younger people now will be getting will all be in computer. We're just in a weird, it's a really weird fucking huge change that's been happening. Yeah.
Right. Come on, robots.
Enough with the robots. It's not good.
Love a robot.
Oh, I love robots. They rule.
The job that I'm training them for, they get a company car, and you know, it's just a sturdy. It's like a sturdy Acura. I think.
What are they?
And
they're limo drivers.
And I've had kids say, "Oh, I don't bring my company car out on the weekend. I don't want people to know that I drive that." I'm like, "What? You're given a car. You don't even need your own car," and they're too embarrassed. They're like, "Oh, I can't drive it. It's not cool enough."
Oh man,
I don't get that.
Are you hiring?
Eric, anything before we hang up?
I mean, we all figured it out too. I figured it out. I have a job right now, but I don't know. I just don't like the oversweeping of millennials.
Personally.
They don't know what they're doing now, and all these stupid articles on the Wall Street Journal and stuff about how millennials don't feel like working, and it's always like the same. They always talk to like one or two hiring people who have to deal with them and say, "Oh, the kids coming out of college now don't know what they're doing."
I can only talk for our little thing here, and I see it. I really do see it with the millennials. They're very, very different. They're sitting around waiting to be told what to do, and they also have this entitlement that they just want things handed to them immediately.
It is the same thing that was probably said about the 60s, too. Like, I'm thinking this is the same thing that was said about the 60s generation. All they want to do is smoke pot and sit around, and now they turn into that.
We're probably sounding like our fucking fathers now, but
give me a few beers.
All right, Eric. Thank you, sir.
All right. Thank you.
Damn.
Wow.
Fucking Gen Xers with their Slavo yelling.
Yeah.
Jesus.
His name ought to be Lado, right or wrong, gang?
Wrong.
Daughter's a race car driver. Kids do understand winning and losing. Okay, I'm sure.
Yeah, in some respects.
Scott.
Yes.
How fast could your daughter drive?
She goes 45 in a dragster, and she's 8 years old.
Aw.
45 miles an hour in a dragster at 8 years old?
Yep.
Holy shit.
Are
they already racing at that age?
Yes, that's when you start, at 8 years old.
Get the fuck out of here. I didn't know this was going down.
Yeah, this is all across the country. Google junior dragsters, and you'll see what it is.
What's she going to be, a top fuel dragster driver?
She follows them.
Oh,
she
man.
Knows who Courtney Force is. But
yeah, she's pretty hot, right?
Yeah.
I saw somebody sent me a picture of her. What's that, John Force's daughter?
Yeah. she's got John Force's teeth, too.
Oh, God, okay.
Really?
That's a little different.
Force teeth.
Wow, yeah. How do you know this, Ant?
I used to actually watch a lot of racing on the Nashville Network back in the day.
Ooh.
American Sports Cavalcade.
Oh, she's not hot at all.
No?
Oh, I
saw a good picture of her.
Well, the one we just saw was a bad angle.
Yeah?
Yeah. Oh, that's
right,
her?
See, that
well,
looks
she
good.
Looks good there.
And for, you know, who you see usually in dragsters. It's...
The side shot was horrendous, but straight on, she looks...
I think
that's the same girl?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
That's unbelievable.
I think posing and made up, she looks pretty good. Is that her?
That's her?
Mm-hmm.
God, all right. Holy fuck.
She's kind of naked in that. Wow, wait a minute. What the fuck? She's naked.
Does her ass look good, though?
I don't know.
Sam, I can't tell.
Get the picture bigger.
Isn't it sad women still have to do that shit? Because you're not going to get a male race car driver naked to try to sell themselves.
All right.
It's kind of sad.
My point is, in racing, there's a winner and a loser, especially in drag racing.
Right.
Every round, somebody's going home.
Yeah, yeah.
And the kids learn at an early age that you go shake hands with the person that just beat you. And they learn that there's a winner and a loser. And it's not just drag racing. You've got kart racing. You've got mini sprint racing. And all these kids are starting at 8 years old. Some stuff's at 7 years old.
Wow, that's fucked up.
So maybe the thing is to find one of these more unusual sports for your kid. Because I think soccer is just evil. Mm-hmm. It's an evil sport. Mars?
Oh, absolutely.
Mars is going to be like UFC.
No,
get your five-year-old punching each other in the face.
The problem is mostly with team sports. Because I got my son in judo. We don't explain winning and losing. You just know that you lost.
Right.
You feel it.
Right.
So we don't have to say you lost. They just don't want to be pinned anymore. They don't want, so they'll come out and they'll come out stronger. So they understand winning and losing in those type of sports, like individual sports like that.
Yeah, it's pretty hard to tell them they tied or won when you just got your ass handed
exactly.
to you.
Yeah, right. Exactly.
There's no way to fake that shit.
Yeah. Like Mars, who was fucking going six rounds with his mom when he was a kid. I mean,
wow.
I'm saying that's a hard one.
Bringing up bad memories.
Sorry, Mars.
Oh, Mars.
That's pretty brutal.
Mars got his jujitsu shirt on.
Yeah, Mars is a fucking...
Mommy's not going to fucking beat the shit out of him anymore, right, Mars?
I don't know, man. She's still got weapons.
All right, Scott. I had no idea 8-year-olds could fucking race dragsters.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's pretty cool.
Google junior dragsters.
I will.
You'll see that there's...
And the top
little kids doing it.
Sorry, the top speed is 45 miles an hour. That's the rule.
That's at 8 years old.
When right.
Once you're up to 16 year olds, I think you can go 79 miles an hour.
Yeah, oh. That's wild.
Any mile.
In an eighth mile.
All right, Scott. Thank you so much.
All right. Have a good one.
All right.
Considering they're fucking pushing, you know, what are top fuel dragsters doing these days? 300, something like that. Crazy,
you know. I we could go for another hour easily.
330 now.
Fuck. 330 miles an hour.
They're doing.
Fuck yeah.
That's
fucking
insanity.
Fucking easy.
Yeah.
Fuck
Chip?
Yeah. I drove a dragster.
No, you didn't.
Yes, I did. Fucking doing wheelies and stuff.
Wheelies? You don't want to do a wheelie
funny
in a dragster. Yeah. How funny was it?
Fucking good.
Shit. Yeah, I remember watching when they were breaking the 300 mile an hour barrier. That's when 330. Jesus. Amazing.
Lightweight, the space age polymers and alloys.
In the military, we can't kick people out for failing PE tests. Well, we know that whole world, too.
That doesn't make sense.
Where they've lowered the fucking standards for some of these jobs.
I've seen some cops that you just look at and go, what the fuck business do you have putting a uniform on? How do they make uniforms that size? Like big, fat, fuck cops. What are you doing?
Should be able to test people.
You have to be physically fit. Firemen, same thing. You got to be physically fit to have those types
of
jobs.
It's a physically fit occupation.
And if you want to turn down a fatso because he's coming in and you say, because you're fat, lose weight and come back and give it a try, you should absolutely be able to do that without threat of a fucking lawsuit and bullshit.
You're too fat.
It's one of those jobs. That's what you got to do. Yeah.
I'm not too fat.
Not you.
No.
I did have Lucky Charms yesterday, though.
Well, you treated yourself.
I will be better today.
Watch them fat fucks at the goddamn tunnel, those cops. Somebody stopped where their Easy Pass doesn't work, and they lumber over.
Lollygag.
Lumbering. Like a sloth. And like, you know, pick it up a little.
There's a line of fucking cars waiting. Oh, they stink.
You don't think they care about the line of cars?
They don't fucking give a shit about anything. They're miserable because they're not real cops, and they fucking they stink, fuckers. And open up another fucking lane with less time than a half an hour after they reopen one of the lanes in the Midtown Tunnel. Then they might swing open another Easy Pass gate at the toll booth. Cars are piling out of the tunnel. They got two Easy Pass lanes to go to, and there's at least four or five of them, but they're closed.
But they slowly open them up. He's right, because I did that same commute.
Open them all up, you fucking cocks.
At least 10 or 15 minutes past when they should open them up, they finally open them up. They're fucking assholes. And we're paying for that shit. And then, so make it convenient for us.
Yep.
And we're paying your salaries, and we're paying to use the stupid road and the tolls.
And they should always all be open.
They should
pass.
What's the fucking problem? Open. Then they open up the other lane, because they have three lanes going inbound and one lane going out in the morning. And then when I'm coming in, they have to reopen it so it's two in and two out. And the time it takes for them to clear that tunnel of the inbound traffic and turn it around so that you can now have it's amazing. I'll go through the entire length, backed up in traffic in the one lane, and you'll pop out the other end, and they're just doing nothing. And there's no more cars coming through. They can instantly turn that around and open up another lane. But it just sits there, not being used because,
right.
I don't know. There's no fucking viable reason. They're a bunch of lazy cunts, the bridge and tunnel fucking authority. Fuck them.
Yeah, that Easy Pass shit drives me crazy. It should be one cash lane for any fucking dummy. Refuses to use Easy Pass. You should suffer.
You wait online.
You should suffer.
Right.
But I don't want them to know where I'm going.
No.
Meanwhile, they fucking...
Photograph your license plate.
Yeah, it's too late.
It's too late for all that.
You're all over... Yeah, believe me, they now have license plate scanners that are amazing. They're all over. They're cameras that are on cop cars, on light poles and whatnot. And they take pictures of your license plate, run it immediately, and file away photographs of your vehicle and the license plate in some giant database so that if they ever need to find license plate number, blah, 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 whatever it is, they punch into a computer and they will have where this car has been, where it went from point A to point B to point C. They know all this shit. Already. Don't worry about your dumb Easy Pass.
That's why I steal my license plates.
Exactly. You
got it,
them.
Man. You got to fucking mix that shit up constantly.
They also read Easy Passes all over the place, not just at the tolls anymore. There's Easy Pass readers everywhere. So if you're driving through the city, and they say it's just to map traffic patterns in the city, but it's your Easy Pass. It's got a specific number. They know exactly where you are in the city, where you've been, where you're going, where you stopped, all that shit. E-Rock comment.
There was a news story not too long ago where they, with the Easy Pass, right dead center of the dashboard, so anything could hit it, drove through Times Square, the West Side, Upper East Side, and the amount of times that thing was
getting pinged. It went off,
Yeah, they had some little device on it. It was reading on areas that it shouldn't have been read at.
Yeah, it's just read everywhere.
Well, was it possible they confused the Easy Pass ping with something else, like when radar gets mixed up?
No.
Well, they didn't know. They had this device hooked right to the Easy Pass.
Specifically knew.
So that it would go off when they came in through the bridge or the tunnel.
It was reading the Easy Pass.
And that same reading was getting hit all throughout the city.
And all of this goes into a giant database that... can be used, you know, we don't know who's using it. They could say, oh, it's for traffic patterns. But who the fuck knows who's using it? And just the fact that the police department has a giant library of photographs of your car and where it is and stuff. I had one of my cop friends show me. He pulled it up on his iPhone. He had his iPhone. He goes, check this out. He goes to his specific app that's only available to the police and punches in my license plate number. And picture after picture of my truck showed up. Everywhere, all over the city.
Oh, boy.
Yeah. It's crazy.
In front of how many elementary schools? But, yeah, I don't know if that bothers me or not. In a way, I understand the principle of it. But then I'm like, if there's a missing kid or if there's some fugitive.
If they have a license plate on somebody and then they punch that in and see where he's been and what they might get a lead on where he is or you know, who he knows.
Well, maybe his picture was just taken a few minutes ago.
Right.
I think we've been broken down. It doesn't bother me at all anymore. It used to. But, I mean, it's too late.
We have been. And, again, it's always, always under the guise that they're helping you, like the government or the police or whatever. It's a convenience for you. Again, we're mapping traffic patterns. Oh, that's a good thing. Now they can figure out what makes more traffic.
I can wear and divert things or whatever. But it always ends up that it's something else.
Of course.
It's always used later for something else. Club Soda Kenny.
One time.
It's not a guy's.
It's not a guy's.
It's a gal's.
You have no expectation of privacy in the public.
Oh, right. But...
And driving is a privilege, not a right.
It is a privilge. But how about... Yeah, well...
Why the sexy
gun ownership is a right, and that's shit on all the time.
Well, this is what happens when you only get 1 hour's sleep.
Oh, my God. Oh, why only 1 hour of sleep?
I had a piece of work to do last night.
Piece of work.
Oh, yeah. Boy. Huh. A hit?
No. I did something for somebody.
Oh, okay. Oh, that thing? You did that thing for the guy?
That thing next to the joint?
Yeah.
Oh, shit.
For the guy.
What kind of work was it?
Oh, man.
Somebody said, I need you to empty these, and they were a pair of balls.
No expectation of privacy.
No.
Is it really no expectation in public? Wow.
In your vehicle? Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
What about expectation of...
That's why if a police officer lawfully stops you, he can ask you to exit your vehicle if you're the driver.
Ooh. Well.
Let's all talk
about
Kenny.
What if I say no?
Sexy Kenny.
I get beaten. I get tased. Get out of the vehicle. You don't touch me. Don't you touch... There's nothing better than a video that starts with a large black woman in a vehicle with a cop trying to get her out of the car when he first puts his hands on her, and she starts... Do not touch me!
Where do you find
You know
videos?
It's going to end really funny with her doing the chicken on the ground with two wires, two very thin wires coming out of her chest. but now what? No expectation of privacy, but what about what that information's used for? Now, if it's used in law enforcement or something, but what if it's used for something a little more notorious?
Yeah, but what if shit was candy? You could eat it.
Well, all you right. think you don't even wouldn't even have to be candy if you want the truth. It's a bad example. What if shit was candy? The Dom wouldn't charge you so much for it.
Time will tell, Anthony. That's what
time
we have.
Will
time
tell. Court will tell. That's good.
Our
that's
criminal
good.
Justice.
Fortunately, it doesn't tell E-Rock when to get up and get into work. But see, time will tell.
I was going to say, Kenny got 1 hour of sleep.
Yeah, 1 hour of sleep, but that's my loyal and dedication.
I guess that's why I was late today, right? Or
were you late, Kenny?
Oh, no, and I had time
wow.
to make two stops to get, you know,
he was extra
supplies.
Early, actually.
Oh, wow.
Oh. That's you're something. Loopy right now, right?
We're a little loopy.
I am a little brain dead.
Oh, my goodness. All right.
Yeah, but
somebody, you do what you got to do, right,
yeah.
Kenny?
I mean, somebody
That's
called
Kenny's
me.
That's Kenny's motto, by the way. You got to do what you got to do.
Yeah, somebody called me. They said they needed me. So, I got to, you do what you got to do.
You do what you got to do.
Kenny's work ethic is much more than most people's. Like, you know, his work ethic, you can't hold yourself to that standard because he really is a tremendous work ethic.
And Sal, I take pride.
Sal's motto is what? I'll do Sal, as long as the subways are running on time.
Right.
Sal's got some personal problems. You can't solve the issue until you get to the underlying problem.
Ah, right.
Does it rhyme with shomosexuality? what do you think? What do you mean Sal's got some personal issues?
I don't know. He's been off his game.
You know what Kenny's doing right now?
Yeah.
He's so loopy that he's bringing up the nonsense that he talks about in the hallway that he just makes up.
Yeah, he just makes up stuff every day. It's
like
funny
4 hours
as shit.
To kill.
And now he's bringing it to the air because he's loopy.
Because he's all fucked up, yeah.
Like, he just started the other day going up to Sal and saying, what's wrong? Sal would say nothing. And he'd go, no, you'll say something's wrong.
If you don't want to tell me, that's fine. It's probably none of my business, but,
But you just feel it.
Yeah.
You feel that there's something wrong.
You know.
Yeah. All right. I have intuition.
You certainly do.
I gotta play a little something for everybody. Thanks, Kenny.
Oh, what do you got?
It's fun. A little fun.
Ooh, I like
this
fun.
This show is a lot of fun.
It is, right?
I think I have rupees in my wallet right now.
From your old from your trip? You got a rupee in your wallet.
I think I do.
That sounds a little, you gotta be kidding. There is the rupee chart.
Thank
just in case you're wondering where the rupee is. The dollar had been soaring. Look what happened when we said we're gonna keep pumping.
I do.
A rupee. He's got a rupee in her wallet.
50s.
Look at one's Gandhi.
One's worth 10 and one's worth 50. What do you mean?
Gandhi's on the rupee.
Yeah.
Look at that.
Oh. Not surprised.
Is it Gandhi?
Yeah.
Is this Gandhi? No, yeah, I can't make any jokes about that. I mean,
the Reserve Bank of India is marked right
on. I can't do it.
You can't. Please don't. Let's go.
I really can't?
No, you can't.
Oh, no.
Are they good at 7-Eleven?
Oh, stop.
All right, I won't. Let's look at the, that people may say that all the time, right?
Oh, you're nervous.
They do. They do say that all the time. They say it all the time.
Look, I've heard that.
It is.
Before.
All right, I'm sorry. I take it back. I apologize before I have to. Let's look at the, yeah, that's right, because of Miss America. Got all kinds of flack from the tweets, yeah.
See, I don't blame anyone in that scenario because that's the world we now live in. You're scared shitless.
Oh, my God.
It's sad. It shouldn't be that way. But the guy made, imitating an Indian.
It wasn't even funny.
Yeah, no, you couldn't have handled it worse.
Right, he handled it
just made
terribly.
It as awkward as humanly possible.
And he didn't just blurt it out and then go, oh, sorry. Like, he knew. He had a chance to think it out and go, should I say this?
Oh, that rupee.
And it wasn't very funny.
But, I mean, they're talking about Indian money.
It's an old hack joke.
He does the Indian accent and makes a 7-Eleven joke.
Yeah.
The fact is, every 7-Eleven has an Indian.
Yeah, Simpsons, have made a little character there
over
the years.
Well, it's a cartoon. We've taught that lesson a long time ago. You can do it in cartoons.
Yes.
You cannot do it just being a regular person.
No.
Yeah, I don't think that was a big deal either.
What, that?
Yeah, but
you can hear the panic. Oh, I know. People know that people do get fired for that
Very
shit.
Very frightened.
You cannot do an accent on TV or radio.
Yeah.
In most cases.
If you're white.
Well, yeah.
Right.
You can fuck around if you're not white.
If you're
white people have a very hard time getting away with anything.
But we have it so much better.
But
we're
privileged. We're the privileged
people.
We
know that.
We get away with everything.
Oh, my God.
They just hand out money.
Rules.
Thank God they don't know where the white people money fucking drops are. Where we just walk up and get stacks of cash for being white. Was I supposed to mention that? Oh, shit.
It's not true.
Oh, Chippa. They took you off the list because your mother and Lamar.
Not true.
He's crying.
They're good friends.
Oh, Chip's emotional.
Garbage.
Oh my God, speaking of stupid crying. Did you see that fucking...
Yes!
Oh, they're trying so hard.
I know exactly what you're going to say.
What?
I think you do, right? No?
Mm-hmm. Go ahead.
I don't think he does.
I do.
No, I do.
It's a commercial.
Mm-hmm.
Now I'll just go, mm-hmm.
it's Cheerios commercial.
Yep.
And they're...
Multiracial.
And they're no, not that one.
Fuck.
It's the one... They're trying to tug at your heartstrings with a little kid, and he's talking to his mom. I do believe it's Cheerios.
And what? Cheerios is going to make everything better? It's one of those type of commercials?
No, it's...
Okay.
I
really don't know, obviously.
And the kid talks about grandma, and the mother gets all choked up.
Oh, I saw that one. Because it turns out the grandmother was buying Cheerios when she was brutally sodomized behind the Stop and Shop. With a stick.
That's it.
Did Nana ever give you Cheerios when you were a little kid?
Yeah, she did.
Were Cheerios the same back then?
Cheerios has pretty much been the same forever.
So, when we have Cheerios, it's kind of like we're having breakfast with Nana.
Yeah. Yuck.
Yeah.
How fucking Cheerios are
Well, the cereal itself sucked.
Fucking ew.
How pandering.
It's like we're having breakfast with Nana.
Nana.
And then a kid pulls out an urn and puts it on top.
Sprinkles it over his Cheerios.
Exactly. Right.
To make that shit taste better.
Yeah.
Or they should say, like, we're having breakfast with Nana. And the camera quickly spins around and it's zombie Nana.
Yeah. Right.
Starts eating the kid's face.
Like Norman Bates' mother. Nana's in a rocking chair. Kill your child with Cheerios.
They're trying so fucking hard there
that
for a moment.
Stunk.
And it's so It's ham-handed.
It's a weird way to sell cereal.
Yeah. Ham-handed.
And that kid's a douche. I don't like the fact that he's like asking these emotional questions. Is it the same as when you... Who cares?
And
it's a fucking shitty no-sugar cereal.
A kid wouldn't ask that either.
What kid's happy about Cheerios?
They're nobody. Not. You want sugar frosted flakes.
Right.
Here's the deep conversations I used to have with my mom at that age. When are cartoons on?
Right.
When are the good cartoons? Because I couldn't distinguish Saturday from Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, and Sunday.
Right.
So I'd be like, is today good cartoons day?
It's funny you bring that
up. Yeah, okay.
Last night I was thinking about this. My kid, I'm going to watch cartoons now. And he takes the laptop and figures it all out himself. And I'm sitting there, I was like having a Jimmy moment. Just, wow, this is amazing. Because I'm thinking, like you just said, we didn't know when the fuck we could watch cartoons.
No.
We had to wait for it to pop up on TV for a couple hours a day.
Exactly.
Now they can watch whenever the fuck they want. And know what show he discovered recently? And I forgot all about it until he started watching it. Felix the Cat.
Wow, that's...
He's all about Felix the Cat on Netflix.
Is there a new Felix, or it's the
old
ones?
No, it's the old school fucking horribly made...
Felix!
Cartoon.
What was the song?
Get me Felix's magic bag.
The wonderful, wonderful cat.
Rock bottom. Whenever he gets in a fix, he reaches into his bag of tricks. Felix the cat. The wonderful, wonderful cat. You'll laugh so much your sides will ache. Your heart will go pitter-pat watching Felix the wonderful cat.
I wish I could push a button and an anvil would fall out of the ceiling.
Here it is.
The cat. The wonderful, wonderful cat. Whenever he gets in a fix,
he finds some chicks with dicks.
You never know where the jokes are coming from.
Felix, E-Rock is fat. That was a weird cartoon. It's from like the 50s, yeah.
Dude, he fucking loves it.
Felix!
So weird what they get into.
Who was the bad guy? What was his name? Professor.
It's the professor in Rock Bottom.
Yeah.
Felix!
Yeah, that weird voice.
Yeah, he was scary.
It's the song.
And speaking of cereal really fast, because, I'm going with that Lucky Charms thing for a little while until people are completely sick of it. I'm obsessed with Lucky Charms, and I try to say no every day, and I finally failed yesterday for the first time in a week.
Oh.
But I started thinking about that. The reason why I love these over-the-top sugary cereals is because we didn't have them
as
a kid.
Never had them.
And I tweeted yesterday, our go-to cereal was Wheat Puffs.
Ugh! Those are terrible.
And then we would find the sugar finally and sugar the shit out of it. So my mom at that point should have got,
you'd have to.
Frosted Flakes or something. Wheat Puffs, worst cereal ever.
Terrible cereal. Yeah, we used to get the snack packs, too. And you'd go through all the good ones real quick, and then you'd be left with Special K.
Had that shitty one in there.
The shitty ones. A couple of shitty ones.
It was,
Or
regular Corn Flakes, not Frosted Flakes.
Yeah, regular Corn Flakes.
But what did they have in there that was good? The Frosted Flakes was always in the snack pack.
Yeah.
Rice Krispies.
No, we're talking about the good ones.
Either.
They were like three good ones, three bad ones, I think. Go old school, Sam. Try to find the
Captain
snack pack.
Crunch?
No, I don't think Captain Crunch was ever in the snack pack.
You're talking
about
those little boxes, right?
Yeah.
Kellogg's made the
Frosted
snack
Flakes,
pack.
Corn Flakes. Corn Pops was one, Pops. Yes.
And
Apple Jacks.
Either Fruit Loops or Cocoa Krispies.
Did you just say Apple Jacks?
Apple Jacks is the fucking shit.
Oh, my fucking God.
You love it?
I forget, yes.
Oh, let's have an Apple Jacks party.
It's kind of the
today.
Only Apple Jacks are the only cereal I really eat.
What?
That's the only cereal I'll still eat.
Apple Jacks?
Is Apple Jacks.
They're so good, dude.
They're fucking amazing.
I think we got to try it for the show.
Yeah, let's get a box of Apple Jacks.
It's not cheating if it's for the show.
Some Apple Jacks?
We eat what we like.
Fuck Apple Jacks. Mm.
Yeah.
And can we get Cinnamon Toast Crunch while we're at it, too?
Get a box of Apple Jacks, a box of Cinnamon Toast Crunch.
Cinnamon Toast Crunch also has French Toast Crunch, if you want that.
No. Stop trying to make a good thing better.
That's E-Rock, though. He always needs E-Rock. A little extra.
Yeah, I invented it.
He always needs to make everything just a little better.
What happens if we add icing to it?
No, man. It's good enough.
Just enjoy it as it is.
Sometimes it's just good enough. You don't need to find the little extra.
They did the icing.
casing for shredded wheat.
Has the intern left for our cereal yet?
I doubt it.
We'll send him now.
Oh, there's Sal killing it.
Wow, he's
fucking nailing it on the phones.
He's doing an amazing job today, Sal.
Oof. Nailing it on the phones.
We got to take a break because our guests are going to start showing up.
Oh,
we got
shit
Rich
in a
Little
handbag.
In minutes, and then we got Chris Weidman, who is just a fucking animal in the UFC, obviously, and from Long Island, which is really cool for us, me and Ann, at least. And then
Michael Shannon from Boardwalk Empire
is coming in as well. So.
You watch it, right, Sam Boardwalk? Yeah,
yeah. And the Iceman.
He's tremendous, this guy.
I have not seen really good. Boardwalk Empire.
It's good. I can't wait to meet him.
I know. It's a show I want to see. Yeah. I want to watch. He might be the best actor on the show.
Yeah, he's...
I mean, everybody's really good on that show, but he might be the best.
Yeah, he might be.
I was watching a special on the Iceman, not the movie, but the actual guy last night, and they were showing pictures of Roy DeMeo.
Mm.
And I'm looking, I went, oh my God, it's fucking looks just like Keith.
Yes, I thought the same thing.
Dude, he looks just like
Keith. Same thing, absolutely.
It's Keith's uncle.
Yeah, I know.
Keith the Cop's uncle. It was Roy DeMeo.
Wow.
And if you pop up, please, you got it, pop up Roy DeMeo's picture. I was like, because I never really looked at him. It's like a
Holy
fucking
fuck.
Chubby Keith.
Yes. Except Roy was a better citizen.
Oh, shit.
Yeah, that's kind of creepy.
Yeah, find like...
That's his uncle, huh?
He, that's his father's brother.
Wow.
Look at his face right there.
Yeah.
You could totally see Keith.
Yeah, absolutely.
I was like,
wow,
oh my God.
That's wild.
That's hilarious.
So Keith should play his uncle.
Right?
We got to take a break because seriously, Rich Little is on his way up.
The Opie and Anthony Show continues in moments.
Got a legend outside the studio.
Wow. I've, definitely seen this guy. Rich Little.
Wow.
My God. Take a seat, sir.
Are you?
What a pleasure. What a pleasure. You look great.
You look wonderful,
you
sir.
Really do. You look fantastic.
Almost alive.
Sorry we're running a little
late.
We're
on the air, too, so it's good.
Yeah.
Yeah, we just start the show and let it rip, you know?
Oh.
Right onward. Forward, wagons ho.
That's a gentleman. Look how he's dressed.
Yeah. I know. Well,
beautifully.
Always.
We could take a. We can learn from this man.
I remember your performances years ago. Always dressed in a tux, right?
No, not.
You always have a tux on.
No, that's Dean Martin.
Well, I remember watching those too. But
Dean slept in a tux.
Always.
You know, in the gutter.
Yeah. Always very well dressed. I see though the lapels a little thinner. Than back in the old days.
Where oh, yeah.
They were, I loved those suits.
With those long sideburns and those big collars.
Yes, they were out to your shoulders.
Yeah.
Yeah, I remember, my God, years ago, all the great variety shows and specials, and, of course, on The Tonight Show, the great Rich Little.
That's how many amazing. Tonight shows did you do?
I was hosting it, I think, about 10 or 12 times.
Now, and that's just hosting it, or those are appearances?
Too? Appearances, probably 20.
Oh, wow.
Okay. Wow, yeah. That's,
Johnny treated you well?
I never met Johnny. No. He did treat me well, although I didn't get to know him. I don't think
that's what everyone
did.
Says. Yeah.
Yeah, they say Henry Bushkin has a book that's coming out, his old lawyer, and I'm reading it now. And Carson seemed like he was a very elusive guy.
Yeah, he was a very private guy, not too talkative off the air. And he was polite, but you didn't socialize with him. You never saw him before the show, went to his dressing room or anything like that. But he drove his own car to NBC every day. Must have been a shock when he was driving home at night and people looked over.
Right.
That's Johnny Carson. Must have caused a few accidents.
When years ago when you were on like all those many specials and whatnot, variety shows and stuff, there was also Frank Gorshin back then.
Yeah.
Was another impressionist. So much different than you, though.
He had a different style.
A totally different style. Did you feel competitive with him at all?
Well, no, I didn't. I think he did a little bit, but he came before me. But Frank, did the routine of announcing who he's going to do, turning around, fixing his hair.
It was the one, yes.
Getting the face ready and then turning back.
Big
me,
reveal.
I just... I just rattle them off. I would do Howard Cosell.
Then I'd do George Burns.
Then I'd do John Wayne. And I'd do Kirk Douglas. You know, I mean,
no,
I would just
around,
go from one to another very quickly. I've always done that.
And was it something that from a kid you just were a little minor bird?
Yeah, I started imitating teachers at school.
Mm-hmm.
That's how I started. And
cracking
I knew
up
I had something
yeah.
going for me because it wasn't long before the teachers were charging a two-drink minimum and a cover charge.
Now, was it a happy childhood or was it this the product of trying to dissociate from something awful happening?
Well, I was born in Canada. I'm a Canadian. A Canuck, you know.
So it had to be happy. Everyone's happy
you know,
up there.
I came down to the States in 1964, I think, or 63, to do the Judy Garland show.
Oh, wow.
It was my first TV show, yeah.
But, I mean, doing the impressions when you were a kid, what makes you realize you can do... Because that's what impressionists are always amazing to me. Because there has to be such a mindset to just get in and become other people
yeah.
and pick up on their mannerisms. And
well, you know, people used to introduce me as the world's greatest impressionist. And I used to say, no, I think the world's greatest impressionist was Van Gogh, Cézanne, you know, Matisse. They were good impressionists.
What do you consider yourself?
An impersonator.
An impersonator.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, yeah. So, yeah, growing up, you realized you were pretty good at doing this. How did you... make it a career.
As soon as I started to make money, I thought,
okay,
this thing seriously.
Now, how did that happen? How do you go?
Well, I was after I imitated my teachers, which there was no money in that.
Mm.
I started imitating local politicians and the mayor of Ottawa, and then I did the prime minister, and then I started doing some movie stars, and then. Organizations would hire me for shows like you know, the Shriners, Knights of Columbus, and I would go and do 15 minutes, a little stand-up, and they'd give me $5 or $10, and I thought that was pretty good
Righteous.
Being a teenager.
$5 or $10. Yeah, yeah,
yeah.
Wow.
And then make the big move down to the United States for the
yeah.
Judy Garland show.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Wow. How did that go, that first TV?
Well, Mel Torme got me on the show.
Oh, really?
Mel Torme. He said, Richie.
The golden fog.
The golden fog. Chestnuts roasting on an open fire. He was great, Mel
wow.
was. He was a great movie buff.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah. He always watched movies in the buff.
But I fell for that
home
one.
Run little.
But, no, we did watch movies. We did some television together in Toronto, and we would watch movies all night long. We'd go down into the basement of the Holiday Inn. He put up a big bed sheet, and we'd watch movies all night long. He was a movie fanatic.
Really?
Oh, boy, did he know his
yeah.
movies. And that's how we became friendly. And then after we did a TV show in Toronto together, he knew I did all these different voices. I was doing Lloyd Bridges. I was doing Raymond Burr. You know, I was doing a lot of people nobody else did. And he took a tape of all my voices and played it for Judy Garland.
Wow, that's pretty nice of him.
And to see if he could get me on the Garland show.
Mm-hmm.
And Judy was not impressed.
Uh-oh.
Really?
However, when I did James Mason, that's when she was impressed because she had done A Star Is Born with James
with
Mason.
With James, yeah.
And she
yeah.
loved James Mason. So when I did my James Mason, of course, and when I went into that impression of that voice, I was the one that got me on the Judy Garland show.
I remember hearing that one years ago, man, always.
Really sound like James Mason.
That's fantastic.
I used to do a speech from A Star Is Born. That was the one I put on the tape.
Listen to me,
Esther. A career is a curious thing. Talent isn't always enough. You need a sense of timing, an eye for seeing the turning point and recognizing the big chance when it comes along and grabbing it.
That was the speech I put on the tape.
That put you over with Judy Garland, yeah.
Daryl Hammond is a great impressionist, too, impersonator.
Yes, he is.
And Daryl said something weird. He sees voices, and Daryl's a psychopath, but he sees things in color, he said. There's a weird way he sees
voices.
What
does he do, eat crayons?
I don't know. He has a bit of a history of smoking crack, so that could have been it.
But he would give us—he would give us a color. We go, you know, when you're doing Clinton, what color? And he said like orange.
Yeah, he
and
sees he knew it weirdly. Like, yeah. How do you see
Clinton,
a voice?
Clinton's probably the easiest impression for anybody to do.
Yeah,
you know
yeah,
that,
yeah.
Bill Clinton.
Because even Bono
all you
did
is
it.
Put a frog
yesterday.
In your, yeah, in your throat.
Yeah,
you're Kermit the Frog, probably. but you know, Bill Clinton is just, you know, that kind of static in his voice.
Yeah, yeah, you kind of.
Yeah,
get a little gritty in the back of the throat.
Can you see Bill Clinton going, I think I'll clear my throat just a second. There, that's much better.
Bono is on the news this morning from U2 showing, doing his impression of Clinton. I guess they had gotten together for some meeting, and Clinton was late to the meeting. So Bono just started doing this spot-on impression of Bill Clinton. So I guess you're right. Everybody can do a Bill Clinton impression.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Is there anyone you couldn't do that you wanted to do? Is there one that you could just never get?
I would like to do Angelie Jolie. I would like to do her. I'd never be lonely. Oh, there's a lot of people I can't do. You know, they say rich little man of a thousand voices, which is kind of corny. It's really, you know, Long Chaney was man of a thousand faces, and then they said man of a thousand voices. Voices. Mm. I don't do 1,000 voices. I do about 200.
Which was one that you worked on and worked on and worked on and just felt like, ah, I got to let it go? Was there one that you just...
Oh, yeah.
Which
there,
one?
There were many. Let's see. Mike Douglas, when I was on the Mike Douglas show years ago, I could never get him down. There were voices that other people did so well that I just lost interest. You know what I mean? Frank Gorshin did Kurt Douglas and Burt Lancaster and Richard Widmark. I never able to do him. A lot of the older stars, you know. The older stars are better to do because they were larger than life and they were identifiable. You know,
yeah, yeah.
You do George Clooney. If I did a spot-on impression of George Clooney, which I can't do, I don't think it would get any reaction at all.
Right. Right. There was this over-the-top...
Right.
Dramatic delivery with a lot of the older actors that you could really kind of fix on and play it that way.
Yeah.
Did you ever notice it was easy for or easier if you had heard someone do an impression of somebody?
Oh, yeah.
And then pick up on that? I had noticed that over the years. If you try to do an impression of somebody and you can't quite get it, and then you hear someone else do it, you go,
that's right.
Oh, so now you find that little niche.
Yeah,
to do. Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, you can steal a voice from somebody else.
You you were right at the forefront when like Richard Nixon was in office, and you were the guy at that point to do Nixon
David impressions. Fry was too.
Yeah, but he was more of the look like
and a caricature.
A caricature.
I tried to do him more realistically and not make him a cartoon. I once did Nixon in front of him.
Yeah, yeah. How did that go?
I was invited to a garden party at San Clemente. I was in my early 20s.
The Western White House.
And there were a lot of celebrities there. And when I arrived, I thought, gosh, my act is here. And I've never met my act before. John Wayne was there, and George Burns, Jack Benny, Glenn Ford, Glenn Campbell, you name it. They were all there. And Debbie Reynolds, oh, I've never forgiven her for this, she grabbed my hand, pulled me around the swimming pool, threw me to the back of Richard Nixon, and yelled out, Mr. President, Rich Little is going to do you.
Oh,
he thought I was going to shoot him. And he turned around in total fear and looked at me, and I went into my impression of Richard Nixon, and he didn't know who I was doing.
Oh, no. Oh,
I was going, Mr. President, let me make this perfectly clear. I am delighted to be here today. And he looked at me, and then he turned to his wife, Pat, and he said, why is this young man speaking in this strange way? He did not know I was doing him.
The whole time
I was doing him. And, oh, the celebrities were gagging.
Were you sweating?
Oh, I was sweating. George Burns came up to me later and said, I was so nervous, I ate a flower. And John Wayne said, somebody get a rope. You know, but I did a good impression of Nixon, though.
Yes.
Because when I left that party, Pat, his wife, went with me. I couldn't get rid of her for 2 weeks.
Wow. So you basically your impression of Nixon, you bombed at to Nixon doing Nixon
front of a bunch of celebrities.
Well, Nixon had no sense of humor.
Apparently, yeah.
The tapes kind of reveal that.
A man who wore the same blue suit for over 40 years and never took the hanger out of it. How funny can he be?
That's a great comedian's horror story. Just doing the voice to the president. How did Reagan like your impression?
Reagan was much different. Reagan just was hysterical. I mean, I kept pinching myself. I'm talking to the president of the United States, and he's telling me jokes. And he's doing impressions for me.
Yeah, he was apparently a real hoot. You know,
he just loved humor.
His sense of humor is legendary.
I remember he did his Jimmy Stewart for me, which was the standard Jimmy Stewart, wah, wah, wah. And then he did John Wayne, and that was okay. But then he did Truman Capote for me. In the Lincoln Room one night after a state dinner, he went into his Truman Capote, Reagan did. And he sounded a little like Truman Capote like this, you see. And I thought it was pretty good. And then he said, Rich, I don't have a line. I don't know what to say as Truman Capote. Have you got a good joke I could use? And I said, as a matter of fact, I do. Well, I would appreciate that if you would give me that, because I don't know what to say when I do my Truman. So I gave him this joke, and he got a Secret Service man, wrote it on his back, the whole joke out. And the joke was this.
I said, this is Truman Capote. You know, a lot of people think that I wrote in cold blood, but that's not true. No, actually, I wrote in ink.
So Reagan just thought that was hysterical, wrote it down on the back of the Secret Service man, and then he said to me, I can't wait to try that out on Gorbachev. So I thought about that and I'd give anything to see Reagan doing Truman Capote for Gorbachev. Right. Huh? Could you imagine him doing, I wrote in cold blood, you know, and Gorbachev going, that is tough.
He starts doing doing his act.
Well, the next thing you know, the wall came down because he just thought Reagan was out of his mind. He's like, drop the wall. He's going to kill us all. So maybe you helped.
Yeah. One time when I went to the White House for a little tea they were having, and I was late, and I was kicking myself, and I ran down the hall of the White House to the Lincoln Room, and there was Reagan out in front talking to the press, and he looked up and he said, Rich, thank God you're here. I'm starved, and I'm stuck with these press people. And he said, you do me better than I do. You finish this press conference. I said, what? You finish this press conference. I'm going for a cucumber sandwich. And he left. And he left me with the press. And I went into my Reagan.
Wow.
And they were asking me questions. It was the time of the Grenada thing.
Mm-hmm.
And they said, Mr. President, what do you think of Grenada? Well, I think it's the best song that Buddy Greco ever recorded. And then they were asking me other things. And I was answering as Reagan. And he was peeking around the corner.
Oh, really?
Yeah, and listening to me and just laughing his head off.
Yeah, he
apparently
really...
They were asking me questions, things like, what are you going to do for the little guy in America? And I'd say, well, get him a little woman. silly, stupid answers.
Do you see how the world has changed now and you couldn't do that now without throwing you under the bus? And it's just, everything has just gotten...
You couldn't do that today.
No.
You wouldn't even get close to the president.
What do you not like about the business now, about show business now? Because you've seen quite an arc.
Well, yeah, I think it's certainly a lot bluer than it is.
Yeah.
I mean, a lot of the young comics today want the shock value.
Oh, yes.
So they use four-letter words when they don't have to.
Right.
I mean, all those Dean Martin celebrity roasts, they took shots at people, but they were never blue.
Right.
The ones today are really vicious. The language is unbelievable. It's like doing a Friar's roast. I've done some of those in the past, too. Those fries were blue, but they were clever, though.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
They were clever.
Yeah.
I loved watching those Dean Martin roasts.
Yeah, the Dean Martin celebrity roasts are out now.
Is that what you're promoting?
Yeah. I'm going around the country promoting the Dean Martin celebrity roast because I'm probably the only person still living. So I was only 12 when I did them, but they're out on DVD, and I think they're going to be a big seller because people tell me all the time, you know, when there's nothing on TV, we always get out an old Dean Martin roast and watch it. Now they're on DVD, 12 complete roasts, six DVDs with 3 hours of extras.
Who were some of the celebrities being roasted?
And the roasted people on this CD, you know, they did 54 roasts.
Wow.
50 over about 6 years. But this is Johnny Carson, Lucille Ball, Don Rickles, Jimmy Stewart, Bob Hope.
Man. Yeah, I remember the Lucille Ball one was hilarious. God.
I thought the best one was either Johnny Carson or Jimmy Stewart.
Mm.
How many of those were you a part of?
Well, I did 52.
Jeez.
Yeah. I was in my 20s. I was terrified.
Really?
I mean, if you stand up in front of the likes of, you look on your right and you see George Burns, Jack Benny, Lucille Ball, Orson Welles, you know, and then you see Don Rickles, and then you see Dean Martin, you see Frank Sinatra, John Wayne. I mean, it's enough to...
And you're the kid there.
It's enough to make you just... keel over, you know, from sheer terror, you know.
Did you do poorly on any of, was there any of them that you look back on, you're like, oh, I kind of wish I could take that one out of the...
Yeah, there's a couple. I thought, well, you know, I can do that better today, you know. But there are some that surprised me, like the Jimmy Stewart one was great fun to do because I showed Jimmy how to do himself. And we winged it. We didn't script it.
Right. Yeah.
I said, Jim, all you gotta do is just stick out your hand like this and bend over and say, "Wow," just like that. and Jim stuck out his hand and bent over and went, "Wow." I said, "That sounds like a seal in heat, for heaven's sake. That is the worst Jimmy Stewart I've ever heard. Sit down. That's terrible." And it was a very funny
That is funny. And he went with it.
You went with it.
Did you laugh in a few times, right?
Yeah.
How was that behind the scenes? It always...
Chaos.
You always think there was a lot of chaos, perhaps some illegalities going on. A party, going on back there.
Oh yeah.
Yeah,
yeah. Yeah. Everybody was very friendly, and the thing about laughing is that it was quick.
Mm-hmm.
You know, they did such short little sketches, and everybody did it. Nixon was on it. John Wayne was on one show I did where he played a rabbit. They had him dress up in a bunny costume.
It does seem that they were able to get people to do things they would never do anywhere else.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Yeah, it was a popular show.
Yeah. Wow. I wasn't allowed to watch it, but I would sneak out of my room and kind of peek out of the bedroom door and watch it until my father saw that we were peeking. And then, well, you know, back then I probably got a SWAT.
Yeah.
So, like Pavlov's dog, I watch it now and I wince in pain.
Are you still doing the next date Rich has, by the way, for a show? It's called Jimmy Stewart and Friends, starring you, and it's November the 10th in Sydney, Ohio. So if you're out there, I'm guessing tickets are available now. It's in the Sydney High School Auditorium.
Wow.
And
is that where they got me going? Sydney, Ohio.
you don't like Mr. Little, do you?
It's on the Pepsi.
It was so cold. It was so cold in Sydney, Ohio this morning.
How cold was it?
An exhibitionist came up to me and had to describe himself to me. No, that'll be fun. I just finished doing the Andy Williams Theater in Branson, Missouri.
Oh, okay. Oh, okay.
That was great fun.
Yeah.
Great fun. Beautiful theater.
Are you still out a lot doing a lot of dates? Or do
yeah.
You,
oh,
you
well, are. I've been doing this show on Jimmy Stewart and Friends.
Okay.
For the last 4 years, and really looks like we're going to bring it to Broadway.
Wow. That's great.
Good for
next
you.
Year.
Oh, wow.
I didn't say we play it here, but we're going to bring it.
Just bring it.
Just bring it and leave it here.
Well, richlittle.com is the website for the dates. If you want anything you want to know about Rich or his, and he's promoting the Dean Martin Celebrity Roast Collection, which is out now, 6 DVDs.
Fantastic.
And the great Rich Little.
Rich, thanks so much for coming in. What a great time.
Good to see you guys.
Come back and see us.
Yeah, I'm sorry I put makeup on for this show.
Exactly.
And when we talked about the Dean Martin roast, I held up the
you did hold DVD. It up. I do like that you held it up.
Yeah, I held it up so you could hear it. Thanks, guys.
Thank you, Rich Little. Thanks so much.
After these messages, we'll be right back.
Chris, what's up? What's going on, man?
How you doing?
How you doing, man?
How you doing?
Good.
What's up, Chris? What part of Long Island? I need to know right off the bat.
Baldwin.
Baldwin.
Oh, yeah.
Huntington.
Okay. Yeah, I just actually bought a house in Dix Hills. We're closing.
Ooh.
What happened?
We're closing. Dix Hills.
Dix Hills. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
Huntington.
Yeah.
I'm closing on a house.
Oh, you're closing on a house in Dix Hills.
Closing on a house. Yeah. Coming on up. Can't wait.
Congrats, man.
Leaving the South Shore for the first time in my life.
Oh, man, that's a whole nother world.
A little scary.
North Shore, South Shore.
It's really two different worlds, North Shore, South Shore, Long Island, with the LIE splitting the
I was East Northport for quite a while.
It was always weird to go south of the Long Island Expressway.
Like, oh, these people.
Right.
Well, and then growing up, there was always fucking, you know, the Bay Shore hair chicks and stuff. Bay Shore, go fuck yourself. Yeah, all that shit.
He might be a little too young for that, actually.
Yeah. Yeah, but that's
you don't remember the waterfall hairdo, right? The bangs, the waterfall bangs. Nah, see, he's too young.
Chicks would like spray their hair, brush it all forward because they wanted that big presentation, like a lion mane. Yeah. And then they turned sideways, and it was just like empty in the back.
We called it the waterfall.
What was that? The '80s, '70s?
Yeah, it was probably '80s.
Chris. '80s.
Yeah, I remember. I got you.
Yeah. Wow, from Baldwin though. That is South Shore.
We obviously were rooting for you just because we're Long Island guys. Now that we know more about you, holy shit!
Yeah.
Congrats on everything.
Thank you, man. I appreciate it.
Yeah, absolutely.
I turned around. I was actually at the fight, and I was.
Were you?
Yeah, I was in Vegas for that, and I was rooting for Silva. And halfway through the fight, I got so annoyed at Silva. I started yelling in favor of Wyman. I got so annoyed at the way he was acting. I wanted to see you beat him.
Certainly did.
Yeah, but I mean, it really, I'm a fan
of
his.
So you're from New York?
Yeah, Jersey.
And you're rooting against me?
Yeah. Not necessarily against you as much as I was rooting for.
No, just stick with it, man.
No, but it wasn't against you. It was, you know.
Uh-huh. I appreciate it.
But I wound up really...
Actually, he's more Jersey than New York, so...
You know what's crazy? Everywhere I go, everybody's confusing New York and Jersey. It pisses me off.
Man.
Yeah, I'm from New York, and I'm not from Jersey.
New York.
Yeah, I grew up in Jersey, and I live in the... I like to call it the Big Apple, because that makes me sound like I grew up here.
Typical Jersey guy.
Yeah. Yeah.
But when in the middle of that fight, you it seemed like in the fucking first round, and a lot of the fighters had you picked, like you know, Chael and Uriah Faber. In the first round, you got Anderson Silva down, and you had him in a it looked almost like a heel hook you're going for?
Yep, heel hook and knee bar. I had him two variations of that. Yeah.
And I think that really frightened him.
Yeah, I felt like I had the advantage on the floor. It's one of those things. It was a high risk move to go for it. There was a good chance to get back to his feet, but I felt there was an opportunity to go for it. I hit him with a big shot on the ground, and I felt he went out for a second.
Oh wow!
And so I attacked the submission, and when I attacked it, he ended up slipping out. Got back to our feet, but I was confident there too, so it was all good.
But then Silva started the taunting. And that's what made me think, like, wow, this Chris really scared him because now he's going into this psychological.
The taunting was more than usual because we all know he likes to fool around.
Well, there's been some fights he's had where it was a lot worse than that, though.
You think?
Yeah, and terrible.
Damian Maia was bad.
There was two fights.
Okay.
When he fought Damian Maia and Talis Latis, it was like, I mean, and he didn't even finish those fights. He was toying with them, and didn't finish them. It was the most embarrassing fights
you
ever see.
Yeah, if you're going to do that, you better knock him out.
Yeah, if you could do all that, you'd think you'd just be like, all right, you could hit him out of nowhere and knock him out anytime you want.
Yeah.
But
so what was happening when that started to happen? What was going through your head?
Stay calm, you know, keep moving forward. I had guys I brought in that would do all that type of stuff to me, you know, boxers and kickboxers. They start trying to mess with me, talk to me, because we knew he was going to be doing that. So just stay focused on what I got to do. But it got to the point when, in that second round, you know, I always kind of imagined that if he was going to start doing that, it was going to be if he was picking me apart on my feet, and I was losing, and he's trying to embarrass me, and I figured I'd be able to keep my emotions steady when that was happening. I didn't expect for him to be doing it when I'm picking him apart. I'm just like, then it just pissed me off. Like, who the hell do you think you are?
Yeah, right.
I was like, I am not. They got to a point when he started fooling around for like. After I hit him with like a left hook that definitely didn't like stun him really, but he pretended like it did, and I was like, you mother, and I just went after him. I just, you know, I threw everything I had at him. I wasn't gonna stop throwing until I hit him, and I ended up hitting that left hook.
So you're saying that when you did, you hit him and he looked like.
That
he
wobble.
Going down, yeah. That wobble.
I doubt. Maybe it hit him decent and he felt like and then he plays it up, making me think he didn't really get hurt.
Uh-huh.
You know, just trying to mess with me.
Yeah.
Like, you can't hurt me.
Took something out of him,
yeah.
Though.
Yeah, and
oh, man.
Made him not think straight, I guess, because yeah. It didn't work out for him.
Oh, did he fucking go
I've
down.
Never been more shocked at a sporting God. Event than watching him fall.
Yeah.
I couldn't believe it. Because again, you're so used to seeing him, at least you knocked him the fuck out. I couldn't believe he connected and knocked him
and
out.
And what was going through your mind? As he's falling over.
Yeah, as you felt your fist hit that
yeah,
face.
Yeah, what was it's going
just,
through your mind?
You know, it's hard to put into words, but at the time, it just kind of finished his fight. Like,
all right.
And then with that left hook, I got to keep hitting him. I don't know if he's going to gain consciousness
uh-huh.
or whatever. But
you had to have a holy shit moment. Like,
oh, I mean,
shit.
when I freaking knocked him out, I got back to my feet. I was like, what? I actually started. They actually took the camera away, but if you'll yeah. see when I'm putting my when they put the belt around me, my shorts, the Velcro's all ripped open. That's not easy to do. I literally started ripping my shorts off. I was stripping down. I don't know what the hell is wrong with me. So thank God.
That's
I did.
A Long Island thing,
yeah,
man.
It's like, ah, you have to take my pants off.
That's usually you see that outside bars, yeah. But that is really a Long Island
that's
thing.
That's crazy. But, yeah, it was crazy. It was a surreal feeling. Yeah, I imagine, yeah. You know, freaking beating him a million times to do it, and the way it happened was just, you know, obviously crazy.
Well, we're all in now with you, man. Jimmy, you're all in, right?
Yeah, I still love Silva, but I really, really like you, too, because that was amazing. I was so pissed off at him for doing that. It's like, this is the number one contender. You can't, what are you doing to this?
Right.
You can't fucking do that to this guy who just put you on your ass in the first round. It just, it really irritated me, and I felt it was for the wrong reasons. It was like, you're just trying to psych him out.
Mm-hmm.
And I was yelling to you, don't fall for it. I'm sure you didn't hear me, but I was so... But I really was irritated. I'm like, don't fucking fall for that nonsense.
So you really started cheering for me?
I'm not bullshitting you. No, I wouldn't really? Lie to you. No, I have no problem saying I was a Silva fan because I like him. And we had interviewed him before, and he was very nice.
Yeah.
But I got so aggravated, I started rooting for you to beat him. And I was shocked that it happened, but I was really glad that it did when it did.
Mm-hmm.
Because it was just unnecessary.
Yeah.
It was unnecessary when a guy puts you down to stand up and start dropping your arms. Yeah. It's like... You know.
Yeah, I agree.
How did you get past the mystique of this is Anderson Silva? Like, how did you never fall for it, or did you fall for it and then get beyond it?
It's always a struggle, you know. Anytime you fight anybody, you see everyone at this stage of the game is good. There's things about them that are, you know, almost mesmerizing. You know, you can look at them and go, oh, wow. But you have to just realize they're, you know, they're a human being. You know, they put their pants on just like you, and that's really it.
In the second round, when he started kicking you, he seemed like he was throwing some, like he was striking a little bit better. It seemed like in the second round, and his kicks are there's almost an arrogance when he throws a kick. Do you know what I mean? When he,
yeah.
The face he makes when he throws a kick, like it's a disdainful thing. And he seemed like he was, he started connecting.
Yeah, he. That was one thing that I didn't expect. I didn't expect him to throw low kicks at all, or to like leg kicks, just because I thought he'd be a little bit more worried about the wrestling. So during the camp, I didn't get leg kicked at all because the guy who usually leg kicks me had a messed up shin in the whole camp. So I didn't. And the kickboxers we brought in were more guys who like flashy type kickboxing because that's what he does. And Anderson's really not known for his leg kicks. So and especially fighting a guy like me as a wrestler, I would think that he was going to stay away from that. So when he started leg kicking me, I'm like. In my head, I'm like, all right, next time you do it, I'm taking you down. But it just wasn't second nature at that time. I just didn't do it for so long. I wasn't taking guys down off leg kicks for a while.
Why is it bad to throw a leg kick at a wrestler?
Because it's easier to get taken down. Just take it, you know, I could just grab your leg and push you over and you're down.
It really is. Like, could a small guy, it's always amazing to me the way, how fast you can put somebody down. It's almost like fighting has changed. you can bring down somebody of anybody of any size, really, if, by grabbing their leg.
Yeah, I mean, depends how big this guy is, and if he knows what he's doing too. But are you asking if I can?
Yeah, or any UFC guy.
I'm assuming
guy.
We can.
Yeah,
or if you can.
Not necessarily.
That's say, what I thought you were going with. That.
No. Let's say a gentleman of my size, of a slighter frame. But if I happen to be trained in fighting.
Yeah, I think you get somebody's leg up in the air and you kind of know what you're doing a little bit. Yeah, it's going to be hard to, especially in the heat of a battle. When you throw a kick, it's just, and you're able to catch his leg and just run him over. I mean, it's hard to really stop.
Mm-hmm.
Whether the guy's a great wrestler or not, it's just too big of an advantage.
And you went to Hofstra University.
Went to Hofstra University.
I say that because you got a degree in psychology.
Mm-hmm.
Does that help you out in the sport at all?
Yeah, I think so. I think.
In what way?
I just know the right type of mindset you need to be a winner. You know, I studied that stuff and realized there's a million different doubts that come to your mind. It's just part of human nature. It's just you have to be able to work through that and keep the positives over the negatives, and just stay confident. It's all about confidence, man. And you're not always gonna feel confident, but all that matters is when you step in that cage, when you touch those gloves, that you're confident.
Right.
And
mm-hmm.
I think that all literally comes from hard work. If you're not working hard every day, you're not going to feel like you really belong in there and you even deserve to win. So that's really where it's at.
Nice.
What's the scariest moment when you first step in? Because I always watch guys right before, like, the announcement or, like, when the other fighter comes in and is doing that, like, little circle around the ring or when they're ready to announce you. Like, what is the moment where you're like, fuck, is there any moment where it's like, the most jarring?
I don't get crazy nervous, man. I've been competing for such a long time. I do a good job at just putting it out of my mind. I give up to God and just say a prayer. And at that point, I just feel real relaxed. But I'd say probably the most, like, oh, here we go. This is, like, all this hard work is about to pay off is when the guy Burt Watson, he's the guy who gets us out of the dressing room and tells us he's ready to go, and he's out of his mind.
Uh-huh.
Great guy. And when he starts saying it's time to roll, and you and your team have to come and start walking, getting ready to walk out, and you're gonna sit and wait for your walkout song to come out, come on, that's probably the time. It's like, here we go, it's time.
Right.
That's gotta be a great feeling though.
Yeah, it's
hearing your song and then you get to walk
when the
in.
Song comes on, man. Fuck. It's like, it's crazy, man.
Right,
everybody's going crazy. It's a pretty cool feeling.
And what is your song?
Won't Back Down, Tom Petty.
Nice.
Mm-hmm.
It's a good one.
How'd you choose that?
Nice.
Would you like work out in the gym and go, I'm going to walk out to that someday?
Actually, I'm not a big music guy. And one of my friends a couple fights ago was like, I think I did like a little Facebook thing. I said, pick my next walkout song. And there's a bunch of songs. And I think I just clicked this. And I was like, wow, I think I like that one. And I've done it for the last couple fights. I think I'm going to do it again. Everybody loves it. I got a lot of people who love it. So
yeah, I don't remember the song.
I don't know.
Oh, you know it.
Yeah, you'll know it.
Play it.
Yeah, where is
it? I can't sing it. I can't remember
E-Rock.
Anything.
Oh no, there's no one at the board. E-Rock,
you play that E-Rock?
Hey,
Spotify it.
E-Rock, could you play it?
Tom Petty, hang on.
Who just
Walk
told you?
Back down.
No. He wasn't there. He wasn't there.
He just like came from the ground on the ground.
Yeah.
Yes.
He's sleeping on the ground.
I love it.
It's just
your whole job is to wait.
Your
whole job is just to wait. I know it sucks.
And he still hear us right now?
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes. You know, they do like big ears.
See, that's the Long Island humor right there.
Yeah.
I feel like he can relate to you just because you're from Long Island.
Everybody give him a round of applause.
Yeah, you know this,
oh,
all right, Jimmy?
Yeah, absolutely. Okay. Yes.
It'd be great if he just started beating the shit out of you.
Yeah, it'd be great for you too.
I do get pissed when I hear this song.
You do? Now, does it motivate you walking out? Or because if other people picked it for you, is it not, since you're not a big music guy, but does it motivate you at all?
No, it motivates. I feel like this is my song now. Yeah, so it motivates me.
Yeah.
Makes me feel relaxed and just like ready to go, just feel good.
Really?
And of course, don't back down. Yeah.
Won't back down. I'm going forward. I won't back down. I won't stand my ground.
What's the worst walk-on song you've heard anybody use?
I'm a little teapot.
Are you kidding?
Yeah, that would be hilarious.
At a smaller show. I want to do that. just get people's reactions. Everyone's got like, mama's going to knock you you out. And right, this right, kid right. comes out with, I'm a little teapot.
Oh, man, the place must have went nuts.
Yeah, that's great.
Then he gets knocked out in the first round.
Oh, that would be probably embarrassing. Yeah, you better know how to fuck him.
He wasn't good.
We should mention Chris has a huge event today. Right?
Yes.
You're going to be at John's gym, right? John Street.
John Street?
Yeah, it's
UFC it gym John on UFC gym on John Street.
John Street here in New York.
Okay. Isn't there a John Street gym too or something?
I don't know.
Okay, I don't want to confuse everybody, but fans will be able to meet Weidman and Silva today, September 25th at 5 p.m. at the UFC gym on John Street in New York City.
And that's a tremendous thing is that both of these guys are going to be there. Only the first 300 people in line are guaranteed autographs. That means there's going to be a lot of people, so get there early so you don't have to bitch that you didn't get in.
Oh, we don't even have to promote. It's going to be ridiculous down there. Do you guys get along?
Yeah, we shake hands. We're not friends or anything like that. You know, I was with him in L.A. and with him in Las Vegas. We're doing this whole world tour thing.
Right.
Is that what we're going to ask?
No, go ahead.
Oh.
No, I want to know why you're not friends. It's just...
I mean, we're going to end up fighting each other. I mean... He has his friends that he's with when we're walking around. I have my group that we're hanging out with, so I'm not going to go over and start talking to him about his family and stuff like that.
Right, right.
So it's really just, it's business. You know, we shake hands, laugh, respect each other, but that's really it.
What did you think, like what did you do that night, like, after you won? Because you weren't hurt. It wasn't like you had to go to the hospital. I mean, you seemed like you were in perfect condition. What did you do after that? Like, after you leave the arena, you shower, like, what happens?
Just try not. I try to get back to the hotel and get to the after party as fast as possible.
All right.
Yeah, that's really it. You know, we had the press conference. You had to wait for that. You got a million interviews you got to do. And then as soon as that's over, just try to get to that hotel room as fast as you can. Get dressed to go out. Because we had two after parties. I was actually like assigned to go to two after parties, getting paid appearance.
Uh huh. So sure.
We gotta get to those. Let's go.
Because you didn't have a lot of money, right?
Not really.
You were
no.
in a tough spot before.
I would not say I had a lot of money at all, yeah. So.
Some say you were close to bankruptcy.
Yeah, I don't know about bankruptcy. What is that, when your business closed down? I don't... Mm. Yeah, no, but that was actually one of my coaches who said that, so that was a little far-fetched.
Okay.
That was a little far-fetched, but I wasn't bankrupt. You know, I got hit by Hurricane Sandy. My house got completely ruined. I had to move into my parents' house, which is in Baldwin, but more north, so it didn't get affected like my house did. You know, it was tough times, but I was... Listen, there's a lot of people a lot worse off than me.
Right.
I was all right.
Hence moving to Dix Hills.
Moving to Dix Hills after this last fight. We made that happen fast.
Get away from the beaches, man.
Yes. No. Yeah, my wife, no matter what, she was like, we're not anywhere close to the water. I'm like, come on.
Yeah.
Like this, I'm a South Shore guy. It's hard for me to leave the South Shore.
Right.
But anywhere on the South Shore, if you get nice houses, it's usually closer to the water.
Yeah, creamed by all the canals and everything.
She
get done.
Do it,
you get a good deal down there, though. Because everyone's
really
scared.
Really good deal.
Because everyone's scared shitless.
Because the house I have, no one wants now.
Oh, great.
Yeah, like 100 grand. You know,
Jesus. Ouch. Yeah. Everyone got fucked down there,
yeah,
man.
Yeah, it's bad.
How much is insurance on those places? That's got to be...
Well, they don't even insure it. It goes through FEMA.
Flood insurance, you're talking about? How much is flood insurance? I can't even tell you.
You can't get it or you can?
Well, you can't go through private. It's got to go through FEMA. You can't just go to fucking Affleck and go, hey, I want flood insurance.
Why not?
They're in the flood zone.
Now it's no joke.
Yeah.
They don't fuck around
and
with that.
And now the flood zone's a lot bigger.
They push the levels back further north.
So the insurance companies won't cover it?
Nope. Oh.
What good is flood insurance if you don't live where it floods?
Well, that's
I bet they love Arizona for their main offices.
They'll give you
on the lake in Arizona.
That's the beauty
of them out there.
That's the beauty of insurance companies, of course.
They never want to pay off.
No, they don't want to pay.
They want you paying in. You can get a flood insurance in areas that don't flood.
Right.
And I guess it's if there's a complete fluke or, you know, you bust the pipe or something like that. But as far as hurricanes go and storms, fuck you. They don't want
to deal with it. Florida, it has to be hard to get flood insurance.
Yeah, again, anywhere there's you're in a hurricane zone or anything, FEMA,
buy the
federal.
House. Buy the house. You own it and you're screwed.
It is a risk, man. You know, you're living large on the beach, but every so often you're like,
It's not what it used to be, man. I was on the canal.
What happened?
But the house, you know, a couple years ago, it's just not, I mean, I never really used it I never really used the canal at all.
Oh, you didn't?
It just wasn't worth it, but.
Oh, man, you didn't grab a boat or something?
Man, I was so busy and I didn't have that much money to even get one.
So
now I'm leaving it and I'm like, oh, man.
I could have gotten a fucking boat.
Yeah. Could have done
moved to Northport.
Oh, yeah. God.
Did you hear Iraq whisper in our ear? You heard that, right?
Who was that?
That was him.
I didn't hear him.
I have no connection to him.
So wait, that's the Tom Petty guy?
Yeah.
You heard his voice, right?
Yeah. You distracted me after you couldn't get my song on instantly?
Oh, man!
This is terrible.
See, and he doesn't even know Iraq.
Iraq.
Can't blame us for that.
What will you say? I know you said Michael's here. Who has to go? Chris?
Chris has another interview right after that.
Oh, you're kicking me out.
I'm going to kick down. No, that's your guys telling us.
Oh, no. Iraq is kicking me out.
Iraq.
Well, I guess we should give the plug properly.
Absolutely.
Tell us when, because that's your guys. Let him know.
And of course, UFC 168.
Oh. Yeah, in Vegas.
Oh my God. When is that? December
28th.
28th. Okay.
Did you want it to be right, Silva, the next fight you had?
Yeah, absolutely. It was the first thing I said in the cage after I knocked him out. After I cursed a little bit and got mad that he was torn me, and then I went up to him and I was like, "Yo, we gotta have a rematch. We gotta have a rematch." I want a rematch. I knew he was gonna get a rematch anyway. That's before I even got into that cage. I knew if I was to beat him, we're gonna fight again. And I wanted to do that.
Nice.
Is it a mandatory thing?
It wasn't. It's not mandatory. Nope, not in contract or anything like that. But just one of those things that he was a great of all time. You know, known as one of the best ever for such a long time. You know, so he deserves a rematch.
Oh, that's a good way to think of it. And you recently said that you think it's going to be easier, the rematch.
I don't know. I'm expecting a war. You know, I have a lot of, I think he's a stud, obviously. But I'm gonna feel better in this fight than I did in my last. This last fight, I had a year layoff. I had two surgeries. I had Hurricane Sandy. this time, I got everything going my way. You know, I feel great. I'm able to get better right now. This time, I was still rehabbing an injury. And having no money, so there's a lot of things going in my order going for me right now where I'm gonna feel a lot better in this fight.
Cool, man. Hey, thanks for coming in.
Absolutely.
Should we get a move?
Thank you. Pisser.
Huh?
Pisser. Did I get something?
I
normally do.
We got to do it fast. Michael Shannon's outside.
Oh, is he outside? Okay. Yeah. Well, I normally have the fighters. They usually put me in a move or something like that. I've had everyone's. Anderson's kicked me. Fedor's choked me. I've had a lot. But we have to do.
It's like a 2-second thing.
Believe me, I tap immediately.
Or what do you want me to do? On the mic? Like you had to like. Gargle into the mic or something.
I don't want to necessarily gargle.
Fucked up so bad. It was
basically
great.
What
for
kind
two
of move
seconds.
Can you do on Jimmy?
I could just put my hand across his throat and just squeeze.
That'd be unpleasant. No, that would be
hang
really
on,
unpleasant.
I'll take my headset.
Okay. You want?
But I'll tap.
Guillotine.
I've gotten a lot.
Somewhere the arm might bend back.
Yeah, or? But let me where I can tap too. All stay right, within tapping. Now, just tell them what you're doing before you.
Please move. This is a little bit of a Kimura.
He's got my my arm is behind my. Here we go. Right behind here. My hold on. Let me make sure I'll try not to tap your dick.
You just tap on your shoulder right there, and I'll look at it.
Okay, I'm holding my shoulder, and he's lifting my arm very slowly behind.
Your knuckles from the beginning, from the middle of your back to your back of your neck.
Now, what is this that you're doing?
Come more. Don't hurt yourself.
Okay. No, I won't. That's a little bit unpleasant. I can right, feel
I'm
that.
I'm not going to
keep going. A little bit. Ha-ha. Okay. Yeah,
<that's>, ah.
That was very unpleasant.
Well, don't sue me, man.
No.
I'm freaking back to Baldwin.
Yeah, right? Back
in Baldwin. Good luck in the fight, right, man.
A leaky house.
Take care, guys.
Thank you, man. Thanks so much.
Chris, thank you, man.
And you can go downtown tonight and see Chris at with Anderson Silva, UFC gym on John Street. Only the first 300 people are guaranteed autographs.
Ah,
yeah, because I knew he was doing it gently, last second it was.
Thanks, man.
Long Island, brother. Long Island. Love it.
That's all great. Right. We don't even have time to do anything.
Let's just bring
Michael Shannon.
Michael Shannon from Boardwalk Empire.
Can we have a water for him too?
Let's get a fresh water for him, and bring him in. Yes, Michael Shannon, where is it? There he is. Come on in, my friend. All right. God damn, how you doing, man?
All right,
big fan.
What's up, Michael?
Big fan, sir.
Thank you. Thank
pleasure.
I'll take a seat.
Yeah, take a seat over there. Pop right on. We're actually on the air. We do that. We just that. It's easier that way.
We don't have time to break. We don't want
it's like dropping a lobster in a boiling pot of water.
Right into the pot.
Watch him squirm.
Not you.
Yeah.
Something tells me not you.
I'm seasoned stoic.
Seasoned professional. Stoic. Yeah. Is that what you get a lot? You're stoic?
Stoic, crazy, evil, villain, sad.
How much of that is you in real life?
None of it.
None? See, you're a regular guy, right?
We don't believe
well, yeah, I mean, as I was, you know, getting my daughter ready for school this morning, I didn't think this is my diabolical scheme. I just kind of said, do you want to wear this dress or this dress?
Is the guy you're playing on Boardwalk Empire, which you're amazing on that, was that based on it? Because I don't know the real story of Nucky. Like, I haven't read up because I don't want to know what happens. Are you playing a real guy?
Van Alden, a.k.a. George Mueller, is a completely imaginary character.
Okay.
They were very clear about that at the beginning.
Hmm.
Terry told me when I met with them, he said, you know, a lot of these characters are loosely based, such and so, blah, 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 but your guy is totally imaginary. Some people thought at the get-go that it was based on Elliot Ness, but that was not accurate.
All right. Gives you a little more leeway to do, you know, kind of what you want with them a little more.
Oh, yeah. I mean, it's like, Where's Waldo? You can just kind of stick him anywhere.
Yeah.
What's interesting is I am rubbing elbows with actual people.
Mm-hmm.
Like Dean O'Banion, Al Capone,
right.
Nucky, of course. These are all real people. So I'm just being inserted into these situations. They're, you know, Buddy, the Prohibition agent.
Mm-hmm.
I'm sure that wasn't something that actually happened very often.
Right. Yeah.
You started as a Prohibition agent, and it was really like a weird religious vibe to you and then you drowned your partner in the lake, baptizing him like in front of all these black people. Like, it was a really fucking bizarre scene. Boardwalk Empire throws curveballs.
Yeah,
but what's really bizarre now is that like, that's totally gone. Like, I'm not doing that anymore.
Mm. Right.
I haven't even tried to enforce any sort of laws for two and a half seasons now.
Wow,
just,
yeah.
Just like selling irons and delivering flowers. So it's kind of a weird change of events.
Do they tell you where the story is going? So do you know if maybe in the future you're going to get back, or you're just at the mercy of each script?
No, they don't tell you anything.
Yeah.
It's like, like working at some factory where you don't know what they're making. Put on a black hood and get on the assembly line. Right. And go,
something's coming in front of me, and I gotta put it together. And then send it off on its way again.
Yeah, exactly.
What was the biggest script shock you got so far? Like, because you have to, if you're reading along and it's not based on a real guy, they can do whatever they want.
Oh, there's so many. I mean, I've got to say, season one, it said the scene where Van Alden has sexual intercourse with Lucy. That took a while to get over that. pretty strange. And that's when I knew that I wasn't going to be the good guy anymore.
Right.
So that was tough. Basically, every script, it seems like something really bad happens to me. It's kind of like to set up a guy on the sidewalk, someone drops a piano on his head or something. That's what it starts to feel like after a while.
Like, poor guy that's just walking on the sidewalk.
Yeah, exactly.
Getting nailed.
But I think he's finally due for, get his spine back. He's been so, it's really weird. I had a conversation on the street the other day. We were shooting a scene out in Yonkers, and this guy walked up to me. And he said, I watched the show. I really like the show. I'm like, oh, well, thank you. And he's like, but I'm very glad I'm meeting you, because I wanted to ask you, why is your character still on the show?
Oh, shit.
What's the message with your character? All the other characters make a lot of sense to me. But your character is, I don't know. Where's the tension? I don't know. What's going on? And it was kind of depressing.
No,
it was Steve Buscemi that said it.
Yeah, it's Steve Buscemi. I said, Steve, we can't all be superstars like you.
I love your character on this show.
That's brutal.
Truly unpredictable, Jesus. And fairly psychotic scene. I think I hope they keep you on the show for the whole run.
Yeah, me too. I mean, me too. Maybe I'll do something eventually to wake this guy up. I don't know.
Where were you raised?
Kentucky, Lexington, Kentucky.
Mm-hmm. You don't have any accent.
Well, that was quite some time ago.
Uh-huh.
And my father lived in Chicago. So I went back and forth between Kentucky and Chicago.
I almost hear a little Chicago, more so than Kentucky.
I just spent the summer in Chicago. But I've been all over the world. I like that song.
Yeah. All over the world.
So, yeah. Did you try to get rid of the accent, or did that just kind of happen? Because people try to, like, they really try hard to get
it
rid of
it. It comes back, you know. If I go down there, it comes back. I don't mind it. I'm not ashamed of my Southern heritage. It's where all the big movie stars come from.
Mm.
Johnny Depp, Tom Cruise, George Clooney.
Yeah,
Kentucky.
Yeah. Kentucky.
Something in the water. Yeah.
And
Jennifer Lawrence, I might add. The biggest starlet on planet Earth right now.
I watched The Iceman and thought it was fantastic. Great performance, man. Just
thank you.
So frightening. Because the way you played it wasn't like, you know, the normal movie hitman that you would see. It was frightening in your normalcy during your regular life. And as a matter of fact, when you are with your daughters in the movie and you're just helping them get ready for school and, you know, you're not hatching some evil plot right there, but then you're just so ready to and willing to kill somebody.
Mm-hmm.
How much research did you have to do on the actual guy for that one?
I did quite a bit, actually.
Yeah.
There's a very famous interview that he did for HBO.
Of course, yeah.
That a lot of people have seen. It was edited down considerably to put it on TV.
Mm-hmm.
So I got the full unedited interview.
Wow. Oh,
which is like 20 hours.
Wow.
So I would watch that.
What did you think of him as a person when you were just watching that and not really considering your role in the movie, just as a person?
First of all, it's hard to separate that because I'm constantly looking at it from that point of view.
Mm-hmm.
But I found him to be a very tragic figure because I do think he... I do think that he really had some authentic love for his family and that he wanted to be a good person, but that he had been so kind of screwed up when he was a kid that he had this other aspect to his character that allowed him to do these things. That was sad.
Do you find you're more sympathetic to a guy like that if you are researching for a role because you have to kind of delve into the things that made him that way instead of just going, oh, this fucking lunatic?
Mm. Well, we all have our faults. I mean, obviously his...
That's a little more
yours
than
might
just
be lateness. His was putting people in acid.
Yeah, you know. I don't know. I mean, to me, I honestly, you know, I get a lot more pissed off at Ted Cruz reciting Dr. Seuss on the floor of the Senate than I do at, you know, Kuklinski saying, there's a lot of negativity in the world.
That's for sure. Yeah, yeah.
So, I mean, it's a case study. I always feel kind of silly talking about it. Do I condone killing? No, of course not. I don't think anybody should kill anybody.
Mm-hmm.
It's not right. It's terrible. But Richard Kuklinski endured some pretty, I mean, as far as I can tell, some pretty savage stuff during his early childhood. And, you know, that's one of the things I've always been fascinated by is how a person's childhood can shape who they become.
And, right.
And why it's so important to not be, you know, sadistic to children. Because if you do that, then you can wind up with someone like Richard Kuklinski. So
your take on it was so spot on, though, where you talk about that he wanted to be a nice guy. You put that across very well with him and his wife and family.
I've talked to people that knew him, and he was very much, there was one man in particular who said that when he was a boy, Kuklinski would kind of keep an eye on him, give him, you know, spend time with him, give him advice or presents or whatever. I mean, it was somebody that was a stand-up guy and that he had no idea, you know, of this other side of him. I mean, that's the thing is that's also fascinating to me is the double life, the whole notion of how someone could have such two different sides to them.
Yeah.
And I think what's ironic is that it comes from the same place.
like his ability to detach and do evil things and his desire to not be that way both come from the same foundation in his childhood.
Right. Yeah, it was a great movie. I enjoyed it a lot. And of course, I guess you're going to be playing General Zod.
Am I going to be playing?
You are playing. I played him. It's done. You played him. I mean, we haven't seen it yet.
Yeah.
Everyone, of course, is familiar with the original Superman 2.
Yes.
Yeah, yeah.
But how differently did you play it than that one?
Do you have the same outfit on?
The Terrence Stamp?
Yes, that's it. Terrence Stamp.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. It's very different.
Yeah.
You know, Zach, the director, told me when we were doing it that he wanted it to be more earnest and not so much like he's a villain. He just happens to be a general on a different planet, and he's just trying to do his job.
Right.
His job is to protect Krypton, and that's not going very well. And and he's just trying to. And once Krypton is destroyed, he says, "Well, I need to make another one." And it's not about. He doesn't get off on like manipulating people or controlling people. He doesn't want people to kneel or do any of that crap. He just wants to. He just wants a new Krypton. That's all he wants.
No kneel before Zod.
No, that's
no. You're not gonna see that.
No,
it's
no.
It is good because that was kind of a one dimensional kind of thing. It was bad guy.
Excuse me. It looked like Terrence Stamp was having a lot of fun, which is great.
Yeah.
And it was a lot of fun to watch him have a lot of fun. But my guy is not having any fun.
Okay.
That's a great way to describe Zod. He's not having a lot of fun.
Perfectly.
Yeah. Can I ask you about your band? Because we have that you formed a band in 2002 called Corporal.
Mm-hmm.
What kind
mm-hmm.
of, and you just released your first album in 2010. Why did it take 8 years?
Oh, well, both of those dates don't come from me directly. And I can't claim that either one of them are accurate.
Well,
I do know that I started playing, when Corporal started, it was just me and one other guy. And it was basically us just practicing every once in a while. We made this album a few years ago. I don't know if it's ever really gotten a proper release. Like you can walk into the Virgin, buy it off the rack, although there aren't any Virgins anymore.
Yeah, so that's true. In every sense of the word.
Yeah, exactly. They're all gone. All the Virgins are gone. We're playing the New Yorker Festival Friday, October 4th. We're playing at the Bell House, which is in Brooklyn, by the lovely Gowanus Canal.
Oh, boy.
What kind of music?
Eclectic. It says on when you go, the iTunes, yeah, I'm sorry, I'm a Neanderthal. It says on iTunes on our site, it says German folk music.
Okay.
So, I think that's that absurd description kind of sums it up pretty nicely. But seriously, like when people come to the shows, they say, man, every song sounds completely different, which is kind of what we're going for. Because I went to see a band the other night. I won't mention names, but every single song they played sounded the same. So we try and avoid that.
Oh, I wondered what band it is now.
Yeah.
Metallica?
Oh.
Apollo Theater?
Were you at the Apollo Theater? Were you at the Apollo Theater?
Just kidding. Dude. I'm kidding.
Of course. Taylor Swift.
There's a lot of variety there.
That would be interesting seeing you at a Taylor Swift show, though.
Yeah, just towering over everyone.
Yeah.
Being
lurking
menacing.
Backstage in the wings. Just like Phantom of the Opera.
Are you, what's your background? Irish or German?
Well, don't you know?
Shannon, I would imagine.
I don't know.
Irish.
It's mysterious.
I'm just looking like you would actually do very well in a period piece of a German soldier. Have you ever played that? I think they should write a movie around you based on a German soldier.
I think
German
Ray
soldier.
Fiennes did that.
Yes, he certainly did.
I don't know if I could do it any better than him.
Harder than you.
and that Inglorious Bastards.
Yeah, yeah.
I didn't get a call for that one.
God damn it. You've been good on that one.
Let's see, German soldier.
Yeah, it could probably work. But
I've done so many military projects. I mean, I've been a general.
I've been a sergeant. I've been a lieutenant.
Really?
Yeah. I've done a lot of military stuff. Yeah.
Well, you're very sturdy
not
looking.
German. Yeah.
And not
yeah,
German.
Very, very stoic and a very, oh, yeah. very...
Stoic, there's that word.
Yeah. But I'm saying that a very yeah. fucking intense gaze, which uh-huh. is kind of, you know, with the military, that's
I'm
probably...
Good. I'm good with a bayonet, too.
yeah. So. What's the silliest role you ever played?
Oh, there's so many. That's the thing. Let's have a little confab about that. I was in a movie called Kangaroo Jack, which is completely absurd.
Uh-huh.
I was in Bad Boys 2. I got my ear shot off and shoved in the trunk of a car.
Yeah.
Little KKK action.
Yes. Yeah,
that was...
Fuck yeah, okay. Yeah, I remember that.
The brilliant absurdity of that. I did a short film called Mullet. That's pretty funny.
Mullet?
Yeah.
Right.
I did a movie called Grand Theft Parsons with Johnny Knoxville. That's kind of a comedy that not many people have seen.
I guess,
yeah, that's the thing. It's like I've done these other things, but I guess the things that most people have seen me in are the more... serious one. A lot of people saw Bad Boys too.
How long have you been acting, like professionally?
Oh, too long. Too long. Because 23 years.
All right, so you're 23 years in the business, yeah. And within the past couple of years, really, you've made a name for yourself to where people look at you and go, oh, I know this guy from, and they know where they know. It's not just like
or they
I've seen
ask
him.
Me to explain to them why they know who I am,
or why you're on the show.
Yeah, I hit a new level of notoriety. Someone actually said to me, "Hey, I like some of your movies." I was like, "Wow," because it used to just be like, "I saw you in this movie," and now it's like, "I like some of your movies."
Why would people walk up to you and say something so obnoxious and why is insulting?
Why is everyone an asshole?
Everyone's got to be an asshole. Are you on Twitter, by the way?
No.
Oh, good.
No.
Because you want a collection of assholes, you go to Twitter. You want your fucking ego brought down into the shitter.
It's like asshole barnacles.
Yeah.
To the shit.
They just stick there and have to literally be scraped off. Yeah, yes.
Which would be the block.
Oh, my God.
You got a block.
Well, you were nominated, too, for Revolutionary Road.
Really funny.
I was nominated for Revolutionary Road. I lost to Heath Ledger.
Oh, right. Yeah.
It's a good one to lose to.
I was
just watching that movie again the other day, The Dark Knight. He's so good, man.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's just amazing.
You know how hard it is to make the Joker, like, you know, or a comic book character Oscar worthy, and it's like it was
just ridiculous.
He put his heart and soul into that role. You can tell he just really got obsessed with it. Yeah, but yeah, I got nominated. I got to go to the show anyway. That was nice. And Christopher Walken said something nice about me. I can't remember what it was because I was in shock.
It was something nice, though. Yeah. Was it really nice, or I like some of your movies nice?
Yeah. Mike Shannon has been in some good films.
Thank you.
Thank you. A percentage.
Well, what a blast to have you on here, man.
Oh, absolutely.
Michael Shannon, of course, Boardwalk Empire, Sundays, 9 p.m. on the great HBO, where... man, the original programming there is fantastic.
Yeah,
just
they do
amazing.
Nice job.
Yeah. Great to have you in.
Thanks.
You're tremendous, man.
Yeah,
tremendous.
You're fucking funny as hell, man.
Thank you.
I really like it.
I like it.
Yeah.
Michael Shannon, thanks so much, man. Jimmy, you got something to plug before we get out of here?
Yeah, my November 1st show with Dice at the Beacon is on sale now. And the gig I'm doing in Doylestown is sold out. Oh, 5 minutes. And my advice show is from 10 to 11.
Yes.
I'll be here doing my advice show.
Yeah,
and
listen,
I
got to
see my parents, and I have no idea what I'm going to do with them. I'm panicking.
That's Michael.
Have fun with them.
My parents are coming into town for a couple hours today from like 11 to 5, and I don't know what to do with them. I don't know where to go.
It's his parents.
My apartment's very messy. I can't bring them there.
Yeah. Do they like museums?
Oh,
you know, I thought of that.
It's not a bad idea.
Yeah, I don't know.
So reluctant to go to the museum.
That,
you know... There's a good show at MoMA right now.
Oh, is there?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I think I'm going to see some MoMA.
Maybe I can get some scratch from pumping MoMA on the air.
Scratch.
Wait, what's the good? I have to know.
The show at MoMA. Fantastic.
But what's the good show at MoMA?
Yeah, what's the show?
That's just like a history of American paint. I'm not going to make it sound exciting.
Yeah, he already
they got
gave
that
it the
painting
plug.
Of the people at the restaurant. You know, Elvis and Marilyn.
Oh, right.
Yeah.
Oh, right.
James Dean.
Right.
Wave, yeah.
But are it's you... the real one, not the one
yeah,
you see.
Yeah, the real
like
one. Yeah,
Spencer's
yeah.
Gift. Or
yeah,
something.
Exactly. Yeah.
Are you playing Elvis in that movie about Nixon?
Oh yeah, I'm gonna give it the old college try. I mean, yeah, I bet everybody's waiting to see me fall on my face. And, no, it's not. I don't know when it's gonna happen. It's kind of like far in the future.
Yeah,
I gotta grow into it. I think I'm still a little young.
It could be, right?
It's Elvis. That's just later.
That's
later
the years. Yeah, the early yeah. early 70s, kind of yeah, late yeah. 60s, early 70s Elvis.
It's all starting to fall apart.
It's killing me. He sounds like Stephen Wright.
Right. Yeah. A little bit.
Wow. Yeah.
He's stoic.
Yeah.
Yeah, he is. Think.
He pulls it off.
Yeah, yeah. yeah.
Well,
yeah.
you're great, Michael.
Absolutely. Yeah. Michael,
love having you,
thanks
Michael.
For having
thanks
me.
So much, man.
No problem.
Bless.
And Jimmy's up next with the advice show, so stay right where you are.